Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to our final best of three of this qualifier for the Insomnia 55 Challenger Cup. We have in the final FM eSports versus Team Infused, both incredibly strong teams, both winning 2-0 in their semi-final matches. Definitely looking forward to an intense final game. What are your thoughts on this game, Jack or Sigilis?
Well, I mean, I tell you, I'm not sure I have many, because it's too hard to tell, you know. FM, they really looked strong in their last game, but at the same time, it was close. Choke also looked very strong. On the flip side, Infused didn't really bat an eyelid at Team Extreme Supremacy. So if you were to go off that, you could maybe argue that Infused has the edge here. It's hard to say, though, because individually, there were some incredible performances from FM. Tundra on his Irelia, as usual, did not disappoint. And Toaster on Vayne. Man, what a beast.
Yeah, that is definitely true. And I look forward to seeing how these matchups play out. We can see bans already coming through thick and fast. Azir and Rek'Sai both coming out from the side of FM. Now, Azir, I know for a fact Charlie T plays a lot of that champion. Definitely something that he is familiar with, as well as Rek'Sai. We saw how dominant Memento was in their match against TES. And it's not a surprise to see that champion taken off. Meanwhile, Rumble, we haven't actually seen Alfari play any Rumble as of yet. But I guess FM knows something that we don't, and they don't want to give that away. Meanwhile, on the side of Team Infused, they've decided to ban away the Irelia. As we've already discussed, Tundra, very familiar with the champion, as well as Elise. I know Nutri considers Elise an incredibly strong jungler at the moment, so not a surprise ban coming out there. And the final ban will be that Fizz, so definitely removing as many carry potentials away in that top lane.
Yeah, I mean, Fizz, we talked about it yesterday a little bit. There was a level like 9 pentakill on Tundra's Fizz in one game that he played in the bot lane. So he really knows that champion. Same thing with Irelia. Very, very scary. I like that they're first picking Victor, even with things like Alistar open. You know, Charlie T has just been going for that every time he can. It really is one of those champions that Infused want to run all the time if they can. Now, going for a Nidalee here, I think, would be quite interesting. You've got to realize Rek'Sai and Elise are both banned out. So when it comes to the types of junglers that Memento likes, you know, you're looking at maybe like Nidalee or Lee Sin as ones that are still open. I think Nidalee is the preference of Nutri for those sorts of junglers. So picking it away makes a decent amount of sense. Picking it with a Corki too, so you have a lot of poke. Very, very strong.
Yep, that is definitely the case. And I wouldn't be surprised to see a Gragas come out of Nutri. Perhaps not on this rotation, as they already know the jungler for Infused. Perhaps they'll hold on and look for more contested champions. So maybe we'll see an Alistar or a Nautilus come out. But I'm a little surprised that the Sivir has been let through. Infused decided that it was worth giving away and prioritizing the Corki. So I guess they're not that afraid of Toaster playing Sivir. And I do wonder what Toaster's going to play instead, because at the moment, I would argue that the strongest AD carries in the current meta are Corki and Sivir. So be interesting to see what comes out. But we can already see that hover from the Gragas and the Alistar. So nice to see that my prediction skills aren't completely out of whack.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting that they went with that Gragas. Like you were saying, they already know what's up with the jungle. My thinking is that maybe they're trying to hide something until their last rotation. And I'm curious about what that could be. This is obviously a team that has a lot that they can offer in terms of weird strats. You know, Vayne isn't exactly a weird pick, but it's not one you see that commonly at the moment, especially now that tanks are fading out a little bit. So something like that might be, you know, on the cards for Toaster in the next rotation. We're going to have to wait and see. Meanwhile, for Infused second rotation, what do you think they're going to go for? Alistar would have been ideal in their poke composition. Same thing with Gragas, and if they wanted to send Nidalee maybe to the top or mid lane. So what other good disengage champions are left?
We might very well see a Maokai Braum come out. We did see that coming out in their best of three series against TES. So we do see the Braum hover, and we're going to see the Orianna. So I'll talk about the Braum first. We have seen that coming out from Arfan quite a lot. Definitely one of his preferred champions. And as you rightly said, what they did need is a bit of disengage, and that's exactly what he offers in the form of he's got the Winter's Bite passive, which means that while they're running away, they can get those stuns off as often as possible. But also the large AoE slow that he puts down, as well as the massive shield to prevent any hard crowd control coming out from FN, is definitely a solid way to prevent hard engages and reliable disengages. Meanwhile, I am a little bit skeptical about this Orianna pick. As I previously mentioned, when her flash is down, she's very easy to gank. And I know that Nutri on that Gragas will abuse when your flash is down. So the moment Charlie T has no summoners, I do expect a lot of pressure to be heading towards that middle lane.
Absolutely. And this final rotation here from FM, they're waiting it out as long as they can, but it looks like they're not going to do anything too surprising, to be honest. Sivir makes a lot of sense with what they already had, so does Gnar, and it also denies Gnar as a possible top lane for Infused. Comboing that with Braum and Orianna would have been quite threatening, so I like the fact that they've decided to pick it up for themselves. Now Infused, you know, maybe a Maokai here. We were talking about it earlier. They haven't picked up their top laner yet. I think that would be a reasonable choice for them. It would suit what they're trying to do quite nicely. But there are some other options for sure. I mean, what else do you think they could pick?
Well, as you mentioned, Maokai for the team would work very well. But in the 1v1 scenario, I know that Maokai really struggles against a Gnar. So potentially they might be looking towards a Hecarim. Hecarim definitely offers the carry potential that Alfari likes to play, and it can hold its own very well against the Gnar. The one thing they have to be careful of is the risk of a lane swap. Now, I don't know in that best of three series whether or not FM did decide to do any lane swaps, but I'm sure that it is something that they are familiar with.
Ho-ho!
But it does look like we're going to get an Olaf in the top lane.
That's interesting for sure. It kind of changes the dynamic here a little bit too. You know, we were looking at sort of poke with some strong disengage. That's not really Olaf's thing, right? He pokes a little bit for sure, but disengage, I don't know if he knows that word all that well.
Well, what it does offer, right, is for a start, it does very well in the lane against Gnar. He can, while Gnar is very good at kiting, Olaf is very good at chasing, because of his throwing axes, that he can constantly pick them up, they get refreshed on cooldown, and that means he can continuously keep that slow going. So he can stick to Tundra if he needs to, and the chances of him getting kited are a lot lower. But more to importantly, is Ziviz is going to struggle. It doesn't matter how much support he gets from Wisdom or from Nutri, they are not going to be able to keep Alfari off him, so their best hope is to shut him down in the early game. And I'm really worried for Ziviz in these upcoming fights, because, I mean, as we saw in that last game, when it comes to something like a Vayne versus Sivir, Sivir's not the highest damage output AD carry that's available, so they're going to be relying on a lot of damage to come out from Ziviz, and we'll have to see how well he can survive during these team fights.
All right, well, we will see shortly enough. We are going to head to a quick break before we get into the first game of our grand finals. But don't forget, if you want to find out more information, we've got a bunch of social media links that are going to be in the chat for you guys. We'll be right back. I cannot wait to see which of these two teams is going to be looking to take those BYOC tickets to Insomnia. I look forward to seeing them there. I've got my own tickets. It's going to be great. We'll catch you after the break.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to our first game of the final of this qualifier tournament for Insomnia 55. So in this game, we do have FM Esports on the blue side versus Team Infused on the red side. So we're going to do a quick rundown of the lineups for you, just so that you get to know the players a little bit better. So in the top lane for FM Esports, we do have Tundra playing Gnar. In the jungle, we have Nutri on that Gragas. In the middle lane, we have Ziviz playing Victor. And in the bottom lane, we have Toaster on Sivir and Wisdom on Alistar.
All right, well, on the flip side, Infused, they got Alfari in the top lane playing Olaf, Memento in the jungle on Nidalee, Charlie T in the mid lane playing that Orianna, in the bot lane we got Poke and Arfan. Yet again, we're just watching these guys playing on Corki and Braum.
Yeah, we do. So it does look like fairly standard starts of both sides early on. We see once again that early Tribrush ward coming out for Alfari. meaning that they will be able to spot any early invades potentially coming out from FM, but meanwhile it is going to be fairly standard starts for both sides. So I don't expect a lane swap because the Corki Sivir matchup generally favors Corki for the most part, just because of the amount of early pressure that he can apply, especially when he comes back into lane with a Sheen. So I don't expect a lane swap coming out, and it doesn't look like that's what's going to happen. Meanwhile, I'm a little bit interested to see what Tundra decides to do in this early game.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting. I mean, he's kind of hovering deep towards the other side, and it looks almost like he's posturing to shove up really early, which I think would be a good idea against an Olaf. He can't see us that well under a tower.
Yeah, that's definitely the case. And what he, this was something that was definitely potential. He recognized that Olaf might be trying to do a camp. And so to put the lane in his favor, what he did was he tried to tank the wave to get it pushing back towards him. That means that the level 2 advantage that Alfari would get from doing a camp would be completely denied. But Alfari recognized this, quickly ran back to lane, and managed to get a large amount of poke down onto Tundra. So now already early on, Alfari getting a nice health advantage in this lane.
Yeah, and he's actually gotten a lot of CS off the back of that, too. Tundra's got to be careful not to overextend now. And we see another great response from Infused. They're sending Memento up there early. There's no ward in the river yet for Tundra, I do believe. Yep, nope. So Memento, he's looking for it here. He's coming in with the spear. He gets flashed, though. Tundra is able to get it. Whoa, flash forward by Memento. They're really going for this.
Oh.
First blood goes over to Alfari. What a play.
So that all stemmed from the level 1 advantage that Alfari was able to build himself up. He managed to get, obviously, the health advantage, forcing Tundra back, and it actually froze under Alfari's half of the map, and that meant that, as you rightly said, Memento comes immediately top, and he does seem to like these level 2 ganks, which gives him the momentum to be the Memento that his team wants him to be. So definitely impressive performance, and now, with Alfari and that first blood, he's gonna be doing the carry top laner that he loves to do so much.
I wonder if he eats Mentos too. I mean, he is pretty cool and minty. But in any case, he's gonna be roaming back towards his blue buff now, which Nutri has smartly decided to steal away given the pressure that was going on in top lane. Memento, though, I don't think he's gonna mind all that much, because getting that early kill onto Alfari was worth so much. Alfari, he has a potential to become a force to be reckoned with if he keeps this up.
Yeah, so definitely an interesting one already. I like the fact that we've already got Memento memes complaining in the chat. I'm not sure people appreciate our puns very much, so I guess we'll just have to think of even wittier puns as the game goes on. But as we can see in the bottom lane, being shoved up already towards Infused, and I'm sure Infused aren't going to really mind that very much. They're just going to farm under tower fairly safely. Meanwhile, in this mid lane matchup, we can see already Charlie T having a very dominant performance over Sivir. Built himself up a very small CS lead, but definitely having full control over that lane.
Ooh, Memento. He needs to be careful here. There is actually a lot of support coming in for FM. I don't think he can get out of this one. He already used his flash in the top lane. He goes down. Ziviz actually getting the kill credit for that one. Picking up a red buff. Might be able to use that a little bit to harass Charlie T in this middle lane.
Yeah, well, that's definitely going to be a massive advantage for Ziviz. Nutri recognized what was happening in his half of the jungle, immediately told his team. Unfortunately, Wisdom was in a great position to be able to collapse Meemon in the middle lane.
Oh, Charlie T gets flashed on. There's the pulverize. There's the headbutt. He's got to get on out of there. Heal and flash both used by him, keeping him healthy for now. But he's going to have to recall and give Wisdom, or Ziviz rather, good chance to get ahead in this middle lane.
So, not only did Ziviz miss his gravity field, but Nutri also missed his body slam, so a bit of a miscommunication there, a misprediction of what might happen. Meanwhile,
whoa,
in the lane,
Wisdom! That's a lot of damage, dude! I'm not sure you want to do that! He goes down, Poke picks it up. Toaster is actually getting a lot of damage back onto Poke, though. The minion's blocking him out a little bit. Keel having to come across. Not a bad trade, though. If you're Infused, you're happy to get that kill.
Yeah, definitely. I'm a little bit curious as to what Wisdom was even planning. He didn't have his flash available because of the gank in the middle lane. Same for his ignite, which means that he basically walked into the lane without any summoners. And You can't disrespect the damage coming out from a Braum and Corki. The Winter's Bite passive is going to stun you up and add a bit of extra magic damage on top of your face, which is definitely going to put you in a bad position. And I guess he just didn't respect the bot lane from Infused. So a bit of a misplay there from Wisdom, and that's going to give the advantage, a bit of a massive advantage over for Infused. You can see a big CS discrepancy developing in the bottom lane.
It's a little bit worrying to me as well, because Infused, their bot lane in the last few games has been playing so solidly. Giving them any kind of an advantage, it could be disastrous. You know, Toaster, we saw last game his performance on Vayne. That was one thing, but he was playing a character that could become that monster. Sivir doesn't have the same level of potential. She really needs to be careful not to fall too far behind early.
And this is definitely true. Meanwhile, in the top lane, Afari may well have caught Tundra slightly out of position.
Yeah, he's actually ghosting here. He is just going for it. Does a lot of damage and backs off. Tundra is going to have to recall. Teleport will be up by the time he gets back to base with that recall, though. So Afari not making too much of a dent there. Actually, Tundra deciding to stick around. There's not much mana on Afari. That might be why. Arfan coming in from the side in the bottom lane. Can he find someone? Wisdom gets hit by that. Concussive blows passive. He's taking a lot of damage. Valkyrie decides to go in there, but without the Winter's Bite, I think any chance of getting that kill has now disappeared, unless Toaster is a little bit aggressive with Nutri roaming towards this bottom lane. He was trying to bait something in there, wasn't able to find it, though.
Yeah, I can definitely see now. They recognize that Nutri was hanging around, so they tried to bait a bit of a re-engage, but Team Infused had full vision of the river and didn't fall for that one, so good vision and awareness of the entire map from both sides. Meanwhile, in this top lane, a bit of a CS lead developing for Alfari, so this Orlov pick working very well for him in the early game, definitely heading towards his favor, and I wonder what he's going to build. There are definitely a variety of build paths available. He might be heading towards that Blade of the Ruined King. Alternatively, he might be heading towards a Brutalizer. I wonder whether or not he's going to go for an attack speed centered build or maybe a cooldown reduction build. I mean, if he's going for that attack speed, maybe he's looking to, you know, rely on his auto attacks to do a large amount of his damage. But if he's going for the cooldown reduction, perhaps he's relying more on his throwing of his axes as well as the true damage that comes out from his E. We will have to see what Alfari decides.
Yeah, Undertow is strong, especially if you're chasing, because you can just keep getting it up. But the most reliable thing that you can do is probably to go for the attack damage-based builds. We're going to have to see which one he decides to go for, like you are saying. Look at the zone in this bottom lane. It's absolutely disgusting. Arfan just keeping people off of those minions very, very nicely. Infused, they're building up a little bit of a lead at the moment. Look at the gold, you know, they are ahead. The question is, can they maintain that? Because the team fight combo that FM have access to could be devastating in an early dragon fight.
Yeah, and as you're saying that, can they maintain that lead? We do see Memento hanging around the top lane. It is very likely that Tundra will just teleport back into the lane. Ooh, in the top.
Oh, Tundra does need to be really careful here. Actually using the Gnar ultimate to get a kill onto Memento, maybe. He picks it up. They trade, and he still has TP as well, so he's not even losing out very much in that. No assist even went over to Alfari.
Yeah, that was definitely the best case scenario, I feel, for Tundra. He wasn't going to be allowed to back off, and if he stayed under the tower, he was definitely going to get killed, and he wasn't going to get anything in return. So he decided that the best thing he could do in that scenario was to try and get a kill onto Memento, at the very least trade one for one, and that's exactly what he manages to do. So now he's going to put Memento even further behind. That's going to allow Nutri to get vision around that half of the map, and you do see he's already heading towards the bot. Maybe get a gank off, but instead he's just going to clear some vision out. But very well played by Tundra, and he's decided to walk back to top lane so that he still has that teleport available for any potential Drake fights as we are heading towards the mid game.
I think that's super important too, especially given that you've got a Corki on the flip side. You know, once he hits that IE, dragons are going to be a big priority for Infused. They've got a power spike around then, so making sure that Tundra can teleport and be the key ingredient in the Wombo combo is very important. By the way, just to highlight, Infused, MVP for them is the Vision Ward. Their warding has been so incredible all throughout today's play.
It definitely has, but you also have to credit FM. You can see something that I do highlight very often is the thing about vision is, depending on at what stage you are during the game, you need to have your line of vision at different places in the map. And FM realize that at the moment the game is very even. They don't really have any major lead, but they're not majorly far behind, so they're keeping their vision line at the entrances to their jungle so they can see if Memento tries to make any aggressive plays. So once they get a slight lead, once they start contesting for that Drake, they're going to start moving their vision slightly further up. You can already see there's one ward around, slightly further. Oh, meanwhile in the bot.
Yeah, it gets the head but pulverized, but it was kind of ineffectual, to be honest. I don't know how else to put it. Didn't really accomplish very much. Toaster actually taking a lot of damage on the backspin. There comes the Glacial Fissure. Valkyrie in. They're just going ham for it. They smell blood. Toaster goes down. Concussive blows. It gets popped onto Wisdom. Do Polk and Arfan have what it takes to finish up this kill? There's the Unbreakable Will. We've got a roam down from Zavis. Arfan gets knocked back into him. Chaos Storm actually not going the way he wanted due to that headbutt from Wisdom. Bad communication coming out from the FM lineup. And a teleport gets canceled from Alfari. He realizes he doesn't even need to come down. Whoa! Polk flashes from both. There's the auto attack. Why did he stay around for so long? I don't know.
I can only assume that he wasn't expecting that kind of damage to come out from Zivis, to be honest. I wasn't even expecting that kind of damage to come out. Meanwhile, Nutri might be in a bit of trouble.
Oh, has to flash out of that shockwave. Good call by him to get out of there. But this is giving a lot of time for Charlie T to maybe shove up this mid lane, that's for sure.
Yeah, it's definitely the case, but Ziv is picking up that kill in the bottom lane, still doing very well in CS. He's not going to lose too much, just a bit of damage onto that middle tower. I wonder whether or not Charlie T, no, it's unlikely that he's going to be able to pick that tower up for himself, but he will definitely get a lot of damage down onto it. So nice reactionary play there, doing what he can for his team, but definitely impressive from Ziv is moving to the bot lane, doing what he can. But this is what we were talking about with the Sheen. The moment Corki gets that Sheen, he's definitely a massive threat in the bottom lane. I mean, he's already a threat. He's definitely a strong AD carry, but when that Sheen is completed, he becomes a massive risk, and they need to be careful. And I feel like the side of FM did not respect that, because the amount of damage that came out from the combination of Corki and Braum definitely surprised FM, and they were able to pick up onto kill onto Toaster. And now with Adani summoners, he really needs to be careful of this pressure coming out from Memento.
Yeah, and look at what Infused are doing right now, right? Arfan and Memento, they're taking the crab, they're starting to move into the river, roaming mid lane to try and get that shoved up. This is a good signal that we might see a dragon attempt soon, and I want to see some responses from FM. They need to make sure they don't give up too much vision here.
Yeah, that does seem to be the case. So, meanwhile, the game, I want to say, it hasn't been very action-packed, but very calculated plays from both teams all across the map. You can see the first tower now going down in the favor of FM, but very impressively, Infused still hold that gold lead. So, with the... I'm very curious as to where they got that from, because the CS is fairly even across the board, but I imagine that it's mostly coming from the top lane, but... very impressive from both sides. You can see very nice reactionary play, and I feel like the game's really going to kick off when both teams look to contest this first rake.
Yeah, and they definitely want to do it soon. Now that Corki's got that Triforce, it's a great opportunity. The problem is, I think they're trying to spend a lot of time top lane and burn a teleport. Now, Alfari, he doesn't have one right now. This is maybe the best opportunity that FM are going to get to do this anytime soon. The problem is, with a black cleaver being rushed on Alfari, is he going to take your top lane tower in exchange for the first dragon? I think it's very, very likely.
It does seem like that. We'll have to see. Well, ideally, Alfari, I mean, we have mentioned how good his TPs are, so perhaps they're just delaying. They're waiting for his TP to come back off cooldown before they start looking to contest this Drake. But yeah, something that I didn't mention is how good this black cleaver item is. Meanwhile, in the top.
Yeah, he's going in here. He does pop that ultimate, goes straight onto Tundra. It's not going to last that long, though. He needs to be careful of an R ultimate coming down, and he does decide to back off. This has given a little bit of time for Memento to close the gap, though. Are we going to see another one of those flash engages? There's no Mega Gnar anymore. He's not going to be able to use that ultimate, but it's not enough anyway. Wisdom, meanwhile, in that bottom lane, trying to get on to a few of the members with Memento in that top lane. Dragon has immediately been called for the side of FM, and I don't think that Infused can realistically contest this best case scenario for them, take that top lane tower as a consolation prize.
Yep, that is appear to be their best move. Meanwhile, we do see FM with a four-man team moving towards this mid lane. It does look like they're going to be contesting towards this middle tower. You do see Memento getting some very deep vision in FM's top half of the jungle, but look at where Wisdom is. He's around the flank. Are they going to be able to do a dive?
I mean, they might look for one, but given how quickly they can kill towers at the moment, I don't think they need to. Alfari flanking behind Tundra. I think he realizes maybe what's up here. He does come out of the bush. Memento, he's coming in as well. Good bounce and the dodge on the spear. I don't think they're going to be able to catch up to Tundra here. Nice job getting away. And Memento, you know, this is a big difference, a stark contrast to some of his other games. He has not had the pressure he has otherwise done in other games. There's a Glacial Fissure, though. They're going on to Nutri. That's a lot of damage. They pick it up. Tundra, the next target. But I don't think they can really get onto this that easily. Meganar is about to wear off, but there's no mana on Memento. There is no ultimate on Arfan. They are going to get on out of there. So nice try. Actually, Tundra, he might be overstaying his welcome a little bit. Good thing that Undertow didn't hit. We have got some reinforcements coming in, though, for FM. And it looks like Infused, they're going to back out.
And it also looks like FM are even going to lose this middle tower. So a bit of a questionable decision there from Zivista. Oh, Zivista!
Oh, Shockwave! What is he doing? He's got to burn that heal. Charlie T, he is very lucky. Ziv is very lucky that there is no mana on Charlie T, or that could have gone horribly wrong.
Oh, yeah. Again, questionable decision from Zivis there. He roams for the top lane and effectively has no impact on the map. That enables Charlie T.
Oh,
Charlie!
Oh, Wisdom! There's the flash! There's the knockup! Charlie T! He takes a lot of damage. He doesn't have flash, doesn't have heal. Nidalee with the Primal Surge tries to keep him up, but it is not enough. That is being picked up by Zivis. 3-0 at the moment, really having the winning score out of the two mid laners for now.
Yeah, that's definitely the case, and they do burn flash for flash, so no flash is available now in the middle lane. Meanwhile, Tundra might be in a little bit of trouble in the top lane.
Look at him just fancy-feeting around the place, dodging on the Undertows. Can't dodge that one, though. Back turn, Meganar. Is he going to be able to get a good ultimate off? Memento tries to get in around the side, but Wisdom and Nutri are here. Explosive cast whiffs, and Alfari is just going to be able to walk on out of there. Very dicey fight from both sides. We got out Arfan coming up now. I don't think he's going to be able to find anyone, though. Good vision is going to be able to keep them away. Nutri, no, he stayed too long. Is he going to be able to go onto someone on the side of Infused? Maybe he doesn't have that explosive cast, though. Arfan doing a good job of blocking out a lot of that damage from Tundra. Polk is here now. So's Toaster and Ziv is partying in the top lane, but no one going down yet. This could be the tower, though. Charlie T, he's got to shove up this wave.
Yeah. Oh, Charlie!
Just using it to clear the minions, I think, there.
Yeah, it does appear that way, so didn't want to steal your thunder there. Definitely make sure that it wanted to secure that tower. And now everyone very low from both sides, really, but with the numbers advantage available for FM, it does look like they're going to continue sieging on this top tower. I wonder whether or not they're going to be able to pick it up. Yeah, they does look like they're going to force Infused to back away, and FM are going to pick up their third tower of the game. So we definitely saw a lot of trading going on in the top lane, a lot of small skirmishes, and very unfortunate for Nutri missing his explosive casket prevented them from picking up that kill onto Memento, but nevertheless they do get a tower for their troubles, and Polk is just being a bit of a nuisance, throwing out those rockets, denying the back, and yeah, impressive performance from both teams. They don't lose anybody, but you can see immediately Alfari recognizes that we're going to lose the top tower, so he moved to the bottom lane, starts applying that pressure, and now he's looking to take this tower away from FM, and that's going to force the teleport out of Tundra, but with Dragon down and Baron only just now spawning, I can't see any major objectives that are going to rely on that teleport other than the Dragon that's going to spawn in about 1 minute and 45 seconds. So we'll have to see if using that teleport is a massive hindrance as we head towards the next Dragon spawning.
Yeah, I mean, one thing I want to mention is I don't know if Charlie T should have used that Shockwave the way he did. It bought them one wave worth of time. Now, admittedly, he has decent cooldown reduction with his Athenes. It's back up now, but had FM found an opening for an engagement, that could have been really, really bad. So, very lucky, I would argue, for Infused. Now, Wisdom fishing around for some deep words here. Talking about that vision line you mentioned earlier, FM, they have started to push it up the map and put it deeper and deeper into the side of Infused's jungle.
Yeah, so you can see now that with all three inner tower, well, outer towers gone, they feel that they can start pushing their vision line up. So they've got a lot of vision around the river and inside Infused jungle. So they're using this vision to be able to move, you know, to dictate their map movements. They're looking to see where the enemy team are and where they should be moving accordingly. They know that Drake is going to be spawning soon. Thanks to the most recent patch, everyone can see, but is Vism slightly caught out?
Yeah, he looks like it. That said, he's got Unbreakable Will, and Tundra comes in from the side, but actually a great Valkyrie dodges out from that ultimate. Tundra doesn't have that available anymore, and the rest of Infused trying to rotate in here. Afari, he's teleporting in the back, goes on to Zivis. There's a lot of slows coming out, but he's not very tanky. He's gonna go down immediately, and now Infused, they're on the back foot. They gotta get out of here. Shockwave does go on to Zivis and Tundra, but it's not enough damage. A good spear comes down, putting some damage down, but without Toaster here, it really does make it difficult for FM. That said, they still won that fight. I don't know, man. That was a bit of a dicey engage from Alfari.
Yeah, it was. I mean, initially we said at the beginning that I was worried about Zivis and how well he's going to be able to deal with Alfari, but Alfari was just kind of left on his own. Alfari wasn't able to draw anyone else away. Meanwhile, Toaster pops on the hunt.
Oh, here we come. Vizdom comes in. The smite does go down for Memento, and Toaster's taking a lot of damage. He goes down. Vizdom as well is taken out and infused, picking up a quick two kills, turning that fight back in their favor. They got the dragon as well. Very nicely played by Team Infused off the back of losing a member.
Questionable why they decided to go for that engage. They could see that Zivis was out of position, didn't have his ultimate. Tundra, out of position, didn't have his ultimate. There was no need for FM to really force a fight there. They could have just given away. It's only the second Drake for them and the first Drake for Infused. So they could have given that away, but in the end, they ended up just giving away two free kills, and believe it or not, Infused actually have the gold lead, and that's very impressive considering they're actually down in towers, and they're actually a bit behind in CS on some of the lanes, so definitely an impressive performance from Infused, holding their own in this game, even though it feels somewhat like FM are actually dictating the pace.
I think the big thing here is that the picks and the composition on the side of FM are doing more at the moment. It really is going to require a bit of a later game state where Alfari is just a monster juggernaut before I think Infused are going to look like they're ahead, even if they kind of are already. It would be great if Infused could take this bottom lane tower soon, though, and that's what they're clearly putting their efforts into at the moment, rotating Polk down to the bot lane as well as Alfari. That is a good slow onto Vizdom. Look at the damage! This could easily be a tower for Infused.
Yeah, it could definitely be with the armor shred coming out from Polk. And as you mentioned earlier, the Trini Force completed and he's heading towards that Blade of the Ruin King. He's definitely doing a lot of damage. And obviously, Vizdom has no defensive stats. So he's going to take a ridiculous amount of damage when that ultimate is on cooldown. So that's going to give them the final outer tower for Infused. Again, the gold lead still stays fairly similar, but still nice advantage picked up for Infused there. But the thing that I was going to mention earlier is that while I was worried for Zivis, fortunately for him, he's the one that pretty much has all of FM's gold right now. He has all the kills, he has his death cap complete, he has the Mark II on his hex core, which means that he's going to get the speed boost when he uses his Q, and not only that, he's going to have a ridiculous amount of damage. So it doesn't matter if Alfari's on his face if he's got no magic resist, and if he's got no magic resist, then Zivis will just kill him, he'll just pop him off, and you could see how much damage Zivis was doing to him in that last fight, and as long as he has a bit of support helping him out, then it shouldn't be that much of an issue to be able to keep him alive during these team fights. But Ghost is coming up for Alfari, and we'll have to see whether or not Alfari can play the team fight better to be able to pick up that massive threat that is Zivis.
You know, this is actually interesting. This is something I've seen on an Olaf before. I think maybe Alfari is doing it. Picking up that catalyst, I wonder if he's... Oh yeah, he has gone for that Righteous Glory. Really strong item on a champion like Olaf who just wants to go fast onto your face. That said, he's still quite squishy. Do you think that's the best item he could have picked up?
I can understand his rationale because it's not just for him, it's for his entire team. And by having Righteous Glory available, it means that his whole team, it makes it easier for his team to follow up on his engages. But unfortunately, they don't really have the strongest team fight composition. I mean, Nidalee offers a large amount of poke, and that's what they really need to be utilizing. They need to be getting the poke down from Corki, from Nidalee. They need to be getting the early damage down, forcing a target low from the side of FM, and then when there's a target fairly low and they're trying to back out, that's when Alfari's going to pop his Righteous Glory. That's when they're going to try and pick these fights, because if they can utilize their composition properly in this way, then that's the best optimal condition. Meanwhile, for the side of FM, they just want to fight. They've got Tundra on that Gnar, they've got Ziviz on a very fed Victor, and they've got Wisdom on an Alistar, as well as the large amount of crowd control coming out from Nutri. So they have a very good hard engage team fight composition that is perfect for the poke coming out on the side of Infused. And if they can get the right engage and they can fight in the right position, then the majority of team fights should be in their favor, assuming they can engage before the poke or Infused comes out.
And that is really the big question. Like you're saying, you know, where is that poke going to happen is where what I want to know, because at the moment there's no real objectives that Infused can go to and then poke around. You know, there's no Baron Dance happening at the moment. There's no outer towers where they can easily retreat from. If Infused want to go for poke, they pretty much got to go for an inner tower, and that's a big commitment. You got to put yourself at risk to do that. I'm not sure they're strong enough yet that they can do that.
Yeah, I would definitely agree with you. You can see that while they definitely have a lead, I would argue that it doesn't feel very much like they have a lead. You know, the game feels very close. It feels that in terms of items, everyone is very similar. And coming up to this next Drake, we'll have to see whether or not they can get the vision required to get the poke down that they need. You can already see nice damage coming down onto Ziviz and Wisdom from the poke. From Memento, and like at the moment they just need to get vision around this Drake. Drake is going to spawn in 30 seconds. They need to get the Scuttle Crab, and they need to be getting wards around this Drake pit. But right now, FM have full control, and they're in a prime position to be looking to take away this Drake. And with Infused backing away, FM might just pick up this Drake for free.
I gotta be honest, it surprises me the way that Infused are moving at the moment. They completely forgave any opportunity to move down into the bottom river. Now, at the moment they're moving into the Baron Pit, they're threatening it. But are they really going to be able to take this quick enough? That is a lot of damage.
And it does look like they are starting up the Baron Pit, and it does look like they're actually going to get this.
Wow, Tundra's coming in. Oh, he is Meganar, but he gets knocked up before he can use his ultimate. He's taking so much damage, he only hits Charlie T. What is going on, Alfari? He's in the back line keeping everyone off. But there is a great flank coming in from Pope. Shockwave only onto Nutri. Can Charlie T get out of there? No. Even with Flash, he can't. But Memento is now on the backline. Toaster, he goes down to Pope. And Infused, what a call to go for the Baron. Triple kill on Pope. Can he get the Quadra or one of his teammates steal it away? No, that is the Quadra for Poke. What just happened? That just came from out of nowhere.
Well, they recognized that the Baron was they recognized that the Drake was about to spawn. They realized that FM had superior vision, and believe it or not, they gave that superior vision away to FM. It made them feel like they could just go and take this Drake for free, but that meant that Infused immediately thought ahead and felt, right, while you're on Dragon, we're gonna take the Baron, and with an Olaf, with a Corki, they can still do it relatively quickly. And you have to remember that Nidalee gives a decent attack speed boost to whoever she heals, so they're going to be throwing a lot more DPS, and they quickly take the Baron. Tundra's the first one to arrive, but his team is so far away, and the very good disengage coming out from Infused mean that he can only lock up Charlie T, and Charlie T actually manages to kill him out pretty much 1v1. He does get a bit of assistance, but the moment Tundra's down, that front line is gone. I mean, Nutri is still fairly tanky, and FM do manage to pick up two kills, but with the ace now in favor of Infused and the Baron buff on top of that, FM are definitely in a good position to start really utilizing this poke composition.
And Infused even got the dragon because of the point at which FM realized what was going on, the ruse that Infused were trying to pull over their eyes. Really could not have gone better for Infused unless no one died, and you know, I don't think they mind too much, to be honest. Now, with a good siege on the bottom lane and three members of FM just messing about in the top side of the map, you know. There's no contest here, and Fuse are just steamrolling.
It does appear that way. It does look like they're going to start working towards this inner inhibitor tower. Toast is a little bit close to Alfari, though. I feel like he needs to be careful.
Yeah, I mean, our fan is doing a great job with that Unbreakable in order to stop all of Ziviz's poke. And Tundra, he's about to lose Meganard. This is really, really bad. He won't have it up by the time that Infused get in for a second attempt at dealing damage to the tower.
Yeah, and one thing I want to note is Alfari actually only has 135 armor. And considering he only has that small amount of armor, he is so incredibly tanky right now. And you can see that just barely anyone is doing any damage to him. And now they're very close to taking the first inhibitor tower of the game. And this is exactly where the poke is fantastic. You can see the poke coming out from Polk, the poke coming out from Memento. And they just can't hard engage onto this Baroned Up team. They feel that they're too weak. Now all of the momentum is in Infused's favor. It's definitely this swing, this feeling of momentum has swung all of a sudden in Infused's favor. And now they're looking to take this in tower.
And I think they've got the potential to do it pretty easily if they just commit to walking up and hitting it a few times. Maybe split pushing with Alfari would be better, but he doesn't have teleport, so they got to do what they got to do here. Now, interestingly, we were talking earlier about how if you're a poke comp, it can be kind of hard to take inner towers. The problem is, there's so many places you can get collapsed on by
Toaster,
what are you doing, buddy? You cannot walk around in the jungle when you've lost both inner towers in the lanes adjacent. That was very easy for Infused to pick up. And with him gone, this bot lane tower is just not long for this world.
And this is something that Infused have been doing regularly since we watched them in their last best of three. The moment they have a massive advantage like this, they get deep vision and they sit in these bushes and wait for the enemy team to face check. They think they're gone, but they're not. Meanwhile, Nutri engages.
Yeah, explosive catch doesn't do much. Now Fari is just sitting on the back line trying to get on the Ziviz. He does a decent amount of damage. There's the Meganar, flashes forward, gets Charlie T, but Polk is just alive in the back line doing some work. Great Orianna ultimate hits on the three. But FM, they're defending, they're managing to stay in this. Polk is too busy hitting that inhibitor. Nutri, he's the next target. Is he gonna be able to get onto Arfan? It looks like he lands a knockup. Polk has to deal with Ziviz here. Toaster has respawned. He doesn't get the kill. FM, defend!
That is pretty amazing coming out from FM. You can see now with the massive gold advantage on Ziviz, he was able to carry that team fight around. The front line of Wisdom and Nutri, as well as Tundra, really prevented them from getting onto Ziviz. And initially, I felt like Alfari, look, he still has his ultimate. I don't know why he decided not to use it. Perhaps it was on cooldown as a result of going onto Toaster earlier on, but the fact that he was so caught up in all the crowd control, the fact that they couldn't get onto Ziviz and bring him down, meant that he was doing consistent, reliable damage. And with that Lich Bane completed, he was just consistently throwing out a massive amount of magic damage. And as a result, they managed to pick themselves up four kills there, and they defend their inhibitor and get a tower back. So now the gold has actually been decreased. There's only now a 3,000 gold difference between these two teams, and all of a sudden, the game has gotten a lot more close.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, the later this game goes, the better a spot FM are in. You can see Infused really trying to put as much pressure down as possible, but every time it fails, the game starts to slip out of their grasp, because later on, they just aren't going to do quite as much. Except for Alfari, who I would argue probably becomes stronger. Righteous Glory Pop, they're trying to go on the Wisdom here. Undertow doesn't land. Arfan, he's really trying to stick onto this. Great Winner's Bite. Wisdom is really going to struggle to get out of here. Memento coming in as well. I do not know why Wisdom stays so far out without team support, but that is not good news for FM. They need to be giving up as little of these advantages as possible if they want to extend this game until later point.
Yep, that's definitely true, and you can see that he did his very best to try and get some deep vision down, but it ended up backfiring and he got caught out. Meanwhile, FM trying to push in on off.
Whoa! Glacial Fissure coming out here by Arfan. Alfari and him trying to go in. Gnar used in order just to disengage, but we got Memento coming in from the back here. He's flanking. He's not going to be able to go in, though. There is Toaster. There is Nutri. And now Ziviz here as well. This is going to be a hard sell for the fight.
Oh,
that was a blow up on a Memento. Nutri's coming in here, still has explosive cast, flashes forward, doesn't get poke though. That was a disastrous ultimate on what could have been a great catch. Alfari locked up, so is Arfan by that gravity field. Oh, the shockwave misses completely, and FM, they take that fight.
They definitely do, and initially it was looking really bad for FM. Tundra getting picked off by Nidalee, but you saw the huge amount of damage coming out from Sivir. He just dropped his ultimate, and that dropped Memento immediately. It's literally like dropping a Memento into a bottle of Coke. He just exploded everywhere, and while Infuse were trying to retreat, they just were unable to, and that beautiful gravity field locking up both Alfari and Arfan enabled Toaster to catch up with the rest of his team. He used On the Hunt, and thanks to a few lucky crits, he picked himself up a kill onto Arfan. And now, definitely the momentum swinging back in favor of FM. And unfortunately, I just feel it's as a result of some... Well, initially, it was Infused doing... They were being very proactive. They made a very good plan, and they picked themselves up a Baron. And with that Baron, they gained a very solid lead, and they had a very good game plan coming in. But then they overextended. Then they throw that initial lead that they have, and now it's swinging back in FM's favor. FM are doing a good job with getting vision control. They're doing a good job of pacing around the Baron. Meanwhile, we do see Tundra getting a little bit aggressive.
Yeah, I mean, Polk's got to be careful going in like that on a Tundra who is nearly Meganar. Vizdom was coming around from the side, too. It could have gone very badly. Ziv is trying to put some pressure on the Arfan in the middle lane, but both these teams have some really tanky members. It seems very difficult for either one to make a dent through Poke, and that is hurting Infused more than it's hurting FM, because they are more reliant on that Poke that we're talking about. Right now, they need to utilize Teleport on Alfari, Split Push, and try and put pressure everywhere on the map. It's exactly what they're doing. This is exactly what they need to be doing.
Yeah, I like the fact that Toast has been sent bot, because still no real armor coming out from Alfari, but the teleport does come in. It does look like they're actually going to start this Baron off.
Tundra's immediately responding, though, and this time they do not have the numbers advantage they had before. Vizdom, he's going to get collapsed onto, but he gets a good pulverize, knocks Memento way out of the fight. Toaster in the backline, though. Alfari, he is right onto him. There's a good Gnar ultimate peeling for the AD carry. Meanwhile, in the rest of the fight, we got a lot going on. Ziv is doing a good job. Jumps onto the backline, blows up Charlie D, takes out Polk. That is an ace for FM, and I'm pretty sure Infused is just out of this game at this point.
I mean, massive credit to Nutri there. Well, initially, they engage onto Vizdom, but Nutri comes in from the flank, and the carries from Infused get scared. So Nutri, recognizing that they're scared, engages onto them, splits up the team. So you've got three carries on the side of Infused, split up in the top half of the map, while you've got Memento and Alfari fighting with Toaster and Tundra in the bottom half of the map. And while initially it looks good for Infused, the moment that all this hard engage coming out from Infused is wasted on Vizdom and Tundra, it makes it easy for Toaster and Zivis to clean up the fight. And basically, Zivis and Nutri, 2 versus 3 in the top half of that fight. Zivis is just doing so much damage right now. He completed his Void Staff before that fight, and he was just doing so much damage. He instantly drops Charlie T, and when he wasn't expecting it, Polk gets dropped as well. And now it's just everything is swinging in the favor of FFM. They pick up the Baron, they pick up the first inhibitor of the game, and they leave the middle inhibitor exposed. So definitely well played by FM. Fantastic team fight coming out from them.
I really feel like FM kind of outpicked Infused this game. You know, at what point in the game is Infused's lineup significantly stronger, right? It's basically Corki's Triforce Spike. That's about it. They don't have enough late game, especially with a middle jungle. You just don't get the damage you need on your spears. You know, this late into the game, Tundra can walk around doing what he wants. Zivis can burst almost anyone down. It's so hard for Infused right now to find a way back into the game.
I definitely agree with you. They had a very strong early game team, and they were in a position to maximize that early game advantage that they had, but they overstayed at the bottom inhibitor, and their poke wasn't able to be used versus the hard engage. And the moment FM got into the swing of reliably using their hard engage, they were so confident in picking these fights, and you saw that in the last engage. Nutri didn't even hesitate. He just went straight in and forced the fight immediately, and now with the Baron on top of that, there's no way that FM are going to be even slightly scared. They're going to pick these fights without a moment's hesitation, and with the basically full build now for Zivis, I can't see any way of Infused winning these next few fights.
I mean, they've even got the Lich Bane on Zivis. So that just makes his tower pushing so disgusting. I mean, with two inhibitors down, a third is likely going to follow. I think Infused need to start looking towards next game. This is a best of three finals. This is only game one. What do they need to do next time around? That's the big question. But they're going to try and go in here. They need to make something happen. And a great disengage comes out immediately from FM. They can't find anything for you.
Yeah, now the ultimate is doubt for Alfari, which means that he's going to be locked up by the crowd control available from Zivis and Wisdom. So that's not very fortunate. He needs to hold on to that ultimate until he really needs it. It does obviously give him MR and armor, which is always useful when you're running flat out into the enemy team. But right now, the fact that it's all actually it's an incredibly short cooldown, so they might be able to wait. But I don't know if they're going to be able to hold their tower long enough before it's off cooldown again.
Well, it looks like Baron has just faded, which is a big deal, but whoa, that's a lot of burst damage on a Memento Chaos Storm coming in across. Whoa, Tundra, he transforms, gets that base HP, Charlie T, he's caught out, doesn't manage to land the Shockwave on a Toaster due to the spell shield, and now FM, they're just wiping the floor with Infused, rolling through their base, picking up the inhibitor, picking up three kills, maybe four in a second, but all that matters is that the Nexus is next to fall. FM, pick up game one of our finals.
And that is definitely the case. And one thing to note is that it was definitely an Infused game for the vast majority of this game. It was just the moment they overstayed in that bottom lane and gave the momentum back in FM's favor that FM were able to come back and start fighting back. And I feel like if Infused just... I feel that if they pick a slightly harder engage composition, if they looked at team fight slightly... if they pick their engages a little bit more, if they think a bit more carefully before they choose their fights and what objectives they want to go for, then they're definitely going to put up a strong fight. But definitely very well played by both teams. A very close game for the vast majority, and I'm looking forward to how things play out in game two. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to the qualifiers for the Insomnia 55 tournament coming up later at the end of this month, where teams are trying to win five BYOC tickets for the Challenger Cup that will be held later on this month, as I already stated. So we do have FM Esports versus Infused, and this is game two with FM taking a very close victory in game one. So what are we thinking going into game two?
Well, I'm thinking quite a few things, unlike what I was thinking at the beginning of the series. You know, it really, I think, is going to boil down to the pick and ban phase, because both these teams, skill-wise, there's a hairline difference between them. I think it's honestly so, so close. But FM, consistently, over the last few events I've cast this matchup at, has had a very strong pick and ban phase. Last game, we saw it in action. There is a kind of weak poke comp coming in from Infused that wasn't able to really do that much as the game progressed. They've got first pick this game. I'd like to see them utilize it to really get a strong composition, because that's going to be what clinches it for them.
Yeah, and it does look like they're actually going to keep their bans more or less the same. I can't quite remember whether or not we saw a Janna ban last game, but we definitely saw an Aurelia ban. This time, FM are going to have to ban out that Elise, so they don't want to give Elise away over to Memento. As I said earlier, Nutri considers Elise to be an incredibly strong jungler right now, so FM holding off a bit on their bans. I wonder whether or not they'll ban anything. No, they're going to stick to that Rek'Sai ban, and I expect maybe we'll see a Fizz ban. Yeah, there it is, another. So pretty much sticking to the same bans from the side of Infused, and we will see what the final ban will be. I wonder whether or not the Nidalee did a decent early game, but I'm not sure it was a massive threat. I wonder, and they are going to ban the Azir. So bans fairly similar for both teams. I guess both teams felt that there wasn't any real champion that posed a real significance. But yeah, I was about to say, I wonder if the Victor will be first picked this game, and it does appear that it is.
Yep, Charlie T has been favoring that, and Infused as a whole has been favoring that for a long time. Doesn't surprise me at all. We also saw Zivis play it really well, so you're also picking it away from someone. Pretty much an ideal situation to be in. Maybe we're going to see Alistar Sivir on the first rotation from FM. Would be pretty standard if they did do that. Alternatives include things like Nautilus, but I think most likely that's the kind of first rotation we're going to see from FM.
Yeah, there were a few questionable positioning mistakes from Wisdom on Alistar last game, but he definitely had a solid performance overall, especially when it came to the team fights, getting those engages, definitely offering a large amount of peel for the rest of his team, which definitely turned those fights around in FM's favor. So we are actually going to see a very early Shen lock in now. That's very interesting. Yesterday, TIP in their game against Dignitas played that in every single game. So definitely risen to popularity in more recent patches. And I feel that's largely due to the top laners becoming weaker, resulting in Shen just kind of rising to the top. And the amount of pressure that he can provide with his stand United really makes it difficult for teams to try and get picks and make those, like, sneaky plays.
Yeah, it very much does. And actually, Nidalee being hovered over again here by Memento, I was going to say, I'm not a huge fan of that for Infused's lineup. With something like an Alistar and a Victor, do you really need that poke? And I think the answer is probably no. Evelynn makes a lot more sense. And it's going to be a quick Trundle and Orianna picked up by FM. We have seen, I believe it was maybe even Wisdom, playing Trundle support the other day. It did some serious work.
It definitely did. And we will see the Orianna coming out on the other side as well. Now, yesterday we did get to touch a little bit on that Trundle. That's the word I'm looking for. And it definitely did well. And it's interesting because he picked it into Alistar yesterday as well. So I wonder whether or not for Wisdom, Trundle is just his go-to champion against Alistar. And that's a little bit surprising for me because I feel like Trundle has a very weak laning phase. And as we saw from Infused, a Graves Alistar has a very strong, threatening laning phase. So I'm a little bit surprised that he's decided to pick that. But I guess he's confident in the champion. He understands its boundaries. And he did have some fantastic Pillar of Filths. Yesterday, Pillar of Filth. What a strange thing to say, but meanwhile, on the side of Infused, they're going to go back to something like very standard. We saw this a lot, and you mentioned in the first game of today that this sort of composition is very traditional Infused, very, very all-rounded, very offers a lot of decent engage, a lot of disengage, very team fight focused, and very sort of Infused-based.
Absolutely, and I think from now on we should call them Fantastically Filthy Pillars, because it just sounds a little bit better. But Wisdom, he's got to lock in a final pick here, and, you know, it's possible that wasn't what I expected.
So we're going to see a Urgot, that's his name, we're going to see an Urgot Trundle bot lane.
I'm going to let the color caster do all the talking. For now, because I don't got a clue what's going on.
Okay, so Urgot, we haven't seen him played in a very long time, but nothing really changed to Urgot. There was, as far as I can recall, he wasn't really nerfed in any way. It was just that the meta kind of shifted. When Cinderhulk junglers came out, kind of for some reason, as an AD carry and as a mid laner, he just kind of fell off. People didn't really want to play Urgot anymore, but he wasn't necessarily nerfed. And I guess Toaster, I know Toaster's been playing Urgot ever since he was popular, so definitely a comfort champion for him. And I guess they're just going for some kind of, I want to say cheese, but then at the same time, it's not really cheese because clearly both the players are familiar with their champions. So it's tough to say, but like the thing that I'm worried about for FM is a large amount of their damage kind of comes from their mid laner. But then the same thing sort of comes from the other side, because the later the game goes, I would argue that Sivir outscales Urgot. Now, obviously, Sivir outscales in forms of utility, but I would also agree in forms of damage, because she's obviously going to go for the Infinity Edge Phantom Dancer traditional AD carry build, whereas Urgot probably isn't. He's probably going to go for the Black Cleaver Muramana Last Whisper, which obviously still does damage. It's not going to be anywhere near as much damage as the standard AD carry build. So I feel like in this scenario, the later the game goes, it's actually going to be a lot more in Infused favor. So we will have to see whether or not FM can pull out a strong early game and snowball that to an early victory.
All right, well, it's another one of those games I can't wait to see. I feel like, you know, this is just deja vu. I say it every single time we're getting into the spectator delay, and it's because these games are so good. So if you want to see another so good, very good game, don't go anywhere. After this short break, we will be back. More information on all of the stuff that's going on can be found on a variety of social media links. They're going to be in the chat below. Please stick around. This could be the final game if FM takes it. Don't go anywhere. It's going to be an awesome one.
Hello again, ladies and gentlemen. Sorry about that slight pause, but the issues have been resolved. Everybody now is in the game, and this is the second game of the best of three final between Team Infused and FM Esports. So, very close game in game one. We saw an initial early lead very heavily in the favor of Team Infused, and then all of a sudden a swing back in the favor of FM to bring themselves the win. So we will have to see whether or not FM can close out this best of three by winning this game, or whether or not Infused were able to pull it back with this victory. So what are your thoughts on coming into this game?
Well, I think this game Infused has a much better draft than they did originally, and I think that is going to be a big deal. I also think FM have a weaker draft. You know, as it stands, they're really lacking damage against a relatively tanky team. I mean, who's going to kill Alistar? Who's going to kill Alfari? You know, these are questions which I don't think there's a particularly good answer for, and that could be very bad for FM. What they need to do is sort of snowball things out of control, I feel. Or abuse rotations and split pushing to try and make it so Infused can't utilize their team fighting strength. Whether or not that's going to be doable is yet to be determined, and I'm excited to see, because if FM win this, they get those BYOC tickets and they win the qualifiers.
Yeah, and it is very likely that they will earn a high seeding coming to the main tournament. Meanwhile, Tundra is caught a little bit out of position, but he's probably just going to walk away from that. He will take a large amount of poke coming into lane. I wonder whether or not he's still going to go a little bit aggressive.
He's got his four full blades, which is going to heal him up a little bit, which is nice. And the fact that Alfari is doing this blue with Memento does mean that he knows he has a little bit of time to sustain in that top lane anyway. With regards to the bottom lane, though, this is going to be an interesting one, though. How do you think that Urgot, Trundle, is going to do against Sivir Alistar? I think that's going to be a really interesting lane.
I haven't got a clue. I've always considered Trundle to have a fairly weak laning phase, which is why you don't see him picked into absolutely anything. However, I can only imagine that Wisdom really likes this matchup. He must like the Trundle into the Alistar matchup. And oh, you can see the moment he gets level 2, he gets that joyous... The joyous pillar of Fundum, and does get a little bit knock up onto Polk, but not much really going to come of it. But while you were saying they need to snowball, I feel like they do have the bot lane to do that, because what I feel they have is something that I call the Victor effect. Now, the Victor effect is when Victor was first released, he was incredibly powerful, but nobody knew it because nobody knew how to play him, as is often with new champions. And often I would play him in solo queue and I would one-shot my opponent, basically because people had no idea what he even did. And so I called that the Victor effect. And basically what it means is when people are in matchups where they don't know really what their opponent does and their power spikes because they're unfamiliar with the matchup, that's definitely putting them at a disadvantage and they fall prey to what I call the Victor effect.
And you know, it's interesting that you mentioned that, because back when Victor first came out, his damage from his full combo was higher than anything else in the game.
Yeah.
Like, by a long shot. No one realized. Yeah. I was sitting there trying to tell people, look, you know, Chaos Storm, when you put it on them, it deals, like, you know, all of your health. Is that really bad? And they'd be like, oh, he's trash, man.
That was back when DFG was out as well.
Yeah.
And I used to, like, people used to sit there and be like, oh, Victor's not very good, and I'm like, I call him the tank killer, because the moment you complete DFG, I don't care how much magic resist you've got, if I drop my full combo on you, you will die. So yeah, that's why I call the Victor effect. Meanwhile, a bit of aggression in the bottom.
Yeah, they do actually have some good poke down onto Polk, but mana that Toaster is burning through right now is really gonna start to be an issue soon. They can't keep this up.
It does seem that way, but he does have a mana pot. He has decided. One thing we used to see a lot from this bot lane and mid lane Urgot was running Flask rather than something like a Doran's Blade.
The pillar actually does keep him in range here. I wonder if they've got the damage, but here comes the counter gank Memento. He's coming in. Toaster, he needs to get out of there. Flashes away. Arfan, he goes down as well to Wisdom. Wisdom needs to get out of there, though. He's being chased up. Because of that movement speed, though, he's able to get out. So not a bad trade. I mean, Wisdom got the kill on the side of FM, which isn't ideal. But the fact that Memento picked it up on Evelynn is not the end of the world for FM. It's much better than someone like Polk getting it.
Yeah, I mean, if you think about it, it's definitely, you want that early snowball. We know how well Memento does in terms of applying early pressure. And if you're going to give anyone a kill and you want the early snowball to get going, then the best person to give that to is Memento. And I'm sure that with this advantage, he will use it fairly well. You can see he hasn't decided to go back just yet. He's going to pick up a bit more gold, but I hope that he doesn't go for the Runeglaive build. I hope he goes for a more AD-centric and build fairly tanky, purely because I've never been a fan of AP Evelynn. I feel that it really doesn't offer very much and that it's not especially strong, but we will have to... That is obviously just my opinion. Perhaps Memento, who is slightly more familiar with the jungle, will disagree with me, so I'll have to see whether or not he decides to go AD. But as you rightly said, the kill did go over to Wisdom, which isn't the best thing in the bottom lane, but at least they were able to pick up a return kill.
I mean, the thing here, and I think, you know, you're right, sometimes an experienced jungler might want to go AP for a certain reason. This game, I think it would be a bad decision, because there's already a lack of damage on the side of FM. Why not make it even harder to kill you? You still put out respectable damage with a tankier AD build, so going AP seems like it's just enabling FM's lineup to be more effective.
Yeah, that is definitely an important thing to take into consideration. It does look like he's going to go for the Runeglaive build, though, which is a little bit disappointing, and it does mean that if he's the one that's going to be looking to engage these fights, then he's just going to drop very quickly, because as you rightly say, while FM might not have a massive amount of damage, they do have a lot of crowd control, and no matter what, if you lock a target up for long enough and you have the right targets hit him, they're still gonna die.
Yep, absolutely. Tundra actually canceling the back of Alfari there, prioritizing it so much that he took a hefty amount of damage in the trade. I wonder why he's focusing so much on that, or do you think maybe FM are afraid of Alfari ganking bot lane?
There is that potential, but I feel like Tundra just wants to be a nuisance. What I think is, he doesn't, where the current lane is, he doesn't want to go back just yet. But now, a bit of a questionable decision making. Oh, meanwhile in the bottom.
Oh, Polk is getting engaged on. It looks like FM thinks they've got the advantage. Memento comes in. Shen ultimate as well. Scan United onto Toaster. He's gonna get out of there. Can they pick up a kill? Great flash taunt onto Memento. Tundra grabs that kill, but goes down in return. Now Alfari, he's teleporting down as well, but Wisdom is very high health. He's got the shield on a Toaster. Alfari's out of mana. He is gonna go down if he's not careful. Has to flash out of there. The Seeking Missile, not enough, and on the hunt, gets popped just to get infused out of there. So some seriously close fights going down on the bot lane.
Yeah, and while all that is going on, you can see ultimates being popped around the mid lane. Ziv has had to use his cleanse. Oh, but unfortunately, nothing gets picked up in the middle lane. But all that action in the bottom lane, nice counter gank coming out from Nutri. But again, it's very much, FM just doing their best to pick. Well, actually, no. I retract my previous statement. It was definitely a proactive play coming out from FM. That ultimate from Tundra was incredibly beneficial, and a very nice flash taunt picks himself up a kill, but on the return they do hand a kill over to Polk. And if you're going to give anyone the kills, that's not who you want to be giving them to, because as we've already mentioned, the build that Polk is going to be heading towards will eventually outscale that of Toaster. So we'll have to see whether or not Polk can use this now to his advantage, and slowly that tier is stacking up for Toaster, and the sooner he gets that done, the better they can scale into this very strong mid game that they do in fact have in the form of Orianna and Urgot, that's the word I was looking for.
Alright, well, we are having some lag issues on FM's side. They've mentioned it a few times now. Hopefully, like last time, this will be a relatively short pause. But let's take a look at some of the other items that are going on at the moment. Because, you know, we've talked about
the fact that we're going to have a Runeglaive on Memento, and the fact that we kind of disagree with it, but, you know, maybe it'll pan out. He's certainly being aggressive early, which is what you want to do if you're going to go that build. Now, looking at some of the other lanes, are there any interesting builds going on here? I think the fact that we're seeing a very early Spectre's Cowl picked up by Tundra, it looks like he's maybe going for a Spirit's Visage, which is kind of an interesting pick. There is a lot of magic damage on the side of Infused.
Yeah, there definitely is. You can see the magic damage coming out of four of the five members, and he's mainly building it for the laning phase, because when two tanks go up in the top lane, one's really not going to have a massive advantage over the other, so it's going to be a very farm-orientated lane. Meanwhile, as I say that, we do see Nutri heading around for a bit of a flank. I wonder whether or not he's going to try and pick anything up, but it doesn't look like that is the case. So back to farming in the top lane for both top laners. And yeah, I do expect the Spirit Visage, but it works perfectly for Shen. As you already mentioned, he gets nice sustain from his Vorpal Blade, and Spirit Visage just contributes to that. Not only that, he gets more cooldown reduction. Excuse me, so that means he can throw out that taunt more often. So not really that surprising. After that, I expect him to go towards that Sunfire Cape so that his split pushing pressure becomes a lot more deadly.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And I think split pushing is something he's going to be focused on quite a lot this game, given the lack of straight-up fight potential that FM are going to have, especially as the game moves later and later on. Now, in the bot lane, I want to talk about this, because this lane isn't going all that well for FM. There is a 10... Actually, that's a lie. There's a 16 CS lead for...
Yeah, it doesn't... Sorry about that. It does sound like you cut off a little bit there, Tigalus. So hopefully we'll be able to get those issues sorted fairly soon. But meanwhile, in the top lane, we do see a bit of a trade going on. I wonder whether or not nothing massive is going to be made of that. But yeah, as the Sigilus was saying, we do see a bit of a CS differential coming in that bottom lane. But that's mostly due to all the action and the pressure that's been coming out from both junglers in that lane. Meanwhile, both top lane is getting incredibly low.
Oh, Memento, he's coming into the mid lane. Zivis takes a lot of damage, but is he able to get out of there? What a shockwave! Comboed with Nutri's explosive cast. That was a highlight reel play right there.
That was ridiculously impressive. We saw the clip of the ultimate coming out from Zivis. Meanwhile, Wisdom coming in for more.
Oh, he's putting down that filthy pillar, keeping Charlie T in the lane, forcing that flash out of him as well. Zivis did take a lot of damage off the back of that. He's got to be careful not to stick around too long here. I'd like to see someone else maybe help him shove this wave out so he can go back.
Yeah, so that right there is one of the issues with running AP Evelynn. Now, obviously she did get thrown under a tower. We do have to take that into consideration, but she is also incredibly squishy. Zivis did a huge amount of damage onto her, considering her level and the fact that he only really has... Well, he has no real AP items, so he did that with mostly just his base stats and obviously the assistance from Nutri, but this is one of the main problems, and this is the point that you brought up earlier. He's going to be squishy. He's going to be easy to bring down, and if he'd gone a little bit tankier, perhaps he would have been able to survive that gank, but... Now, impressively, the gold lead is still in the favor of Infused, just the same as last game. But now double buff onto Zivis, and with that extra gold from the kill, is probably going to mean that, yeah, he will complete his Athenes, and that's going to be bad news coming into the mid game.
Yeah, that item is going to give him a lot of potential threat around something like Dragon, for example, because he has so much cooldown reduction and mana regen that an extended pokey fight, he can just put the pressure down constantly. So I like that Wisdom, though. He's getting caught out here, trying to get some deep wards. Pillar of Filth, man, that ability is good.
Yeah, he is so good at using those Pillar of Filth. And we commented so much yesterday on his ability to use them, and today he's just getting a repeat performance. Meanwhile, Wisdom again.
Look at that, another double one. Here comes the ultimate from Shen. Stand United. There's a teleport down, though, from Alfari. Memento, he's gonna fall before the fight even really kicks off. Wisdom is staying alive, sustaining so much, and Infused, they've gotta back out here. Here comes Pope. Can he find anything? Toaster with the reverser is gonna manage to get onto him. Pope trying to heal up here. Zivis, in the meanwhile, picks up Charlie T on the backside of the fight, and FM come out 3-1. What a good early game fight for them.
And that all started with a fantastic engage from Wisdom. Absolutely no fear. Well, actually, he did back out a little bit when he got the... But the moment he got the ultimate from Tundra, he immediately turned his retreat into aggression and dived into the front line of Infused. We saw the teleport coming out from Alfari right into the middle of FM, and really that kind of put him in a really awkward spot. But the one most important thing that... I mean, FM got pretty lucky because Ziv is...
Yeah, he's got to be careful. Chilling Smite is keeping him in range for a little bit longer. We've got some backup, though, coming in the way of Tundra. He's going to pass over Ward. That's going to be the get out now signal from Memento. He just backs out of there.
Yeah, so as I was saying, the biggest problem was that the unfortunately we saw a lack of synergy between Nutri and Zivis in that fight, because just as the exploding cast came out, so did the ultimate from Zivis, meaning that the ultimate didn't actually have... anyone at all, so a large amount of damage was lost and somewhat unfortunate. Meanwhile, Charlie T.
Yeah, that's a good pillar of filth in the mid lane. Toaster, he's very tanky, not really taking much damage from Charlie T early on. Arfan coming in here with Memento. Can they find anyone? The slows from Toaster are doing some serious work. Wisdom, he's still alive. He's going on to Arfan. Here comes Tundra, double kill for Toaster. And the rotations around the map are beautiful from FM.
These pillars are just incredible. He's putting them in just the right place, and I'm really interested to see the cooldown on that ability, because it seems to be up all the time. It's on a 10-second cooldown, yet it feels like they're up all the time. He is just doing such a fantastic job setting up picks for his team and enabling them to counter, and this is what we were talking about. Meanwhile, Wisdom again in the bottom lane.
Yeah, he looked like he got cut out a little bit, but actually just going on to pull, there is just so much pick potential on the side of FM. They are finding kills everywhere, and it's what they need to do. FM, they want these BYOC tickets. They have smelled blood, and they are going for it.
This is fantastic coming out from FM, and this is something that we didn't really talk about. We were worried that they didn't have enough damage, but we didn't talk about their ability to get picks, and they really do have a fantastic composition, and, you know, it's because we weren't familiar with Wisdom's use of these pillars, and the fact that he sets it up so well. Meanwhile, Tundra might be in a bit of trouble.
Yeah, looks like they want to get some blood back on Infused. Alfari's tanking up the tower, flash over the wall. Tundra, he's out of here for now. There's the shadow dash. Arfan, though, ruining his day like a bull in a china shop, just completely getting on him, messing him up. Wisdom's coming around here. He doesn't have any backup, though. He's probably got to back out of here soon. Keeping Arfan interested, though, with that pillar of filth. He's got a lot of slows. Ziv is coming in now. Can they maybe try and find a pick here? I don't know about that, with Charlie T so nearby. That was a quick two towers for Infused.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. While a lot of action has been going on, they've still done a very good job of making sure the lanes. Meanwhile, ultimate.
Oh, shockwave. That's a lot of damage. Here comes another pillar. Cleanse on Ziv is, gets him out of that gravity field. There's a stand united just to make sure he doesn't go down. Really solid teamwork coming out of FM. They're going to push down the mid lane a little bit.
Yeah, as I was saying before, Infused have done a great job of keeping the lanes pushed regardless of the chaotic fights that have been going on all across the map. And we can see now that thanks... Oh, Wisdom just... So, he's impressing me so much with this Trundle. He's getting so many picks. He's putting them in... Oh, off on flash!
Oh, he's going in, and Alfari picks up Ziv is almost instantly. Memento coming onto the back line, going on to Tundra. Does he have the ability to get out? It doesn't look like he was pretending he had Shadow Dash. He did not. Double kill for Polk. That's what Infused need, man. They need something like that to get back into this.
Yeah, they definitely do. They currently have the gold lead in their favor thanks to the tower advantage that they do have. And right now, with the numbers advantage that they have, they're in a good position to push. Decided that that's not what they want to do, and so we're going to go back into farm mode for both teams, and definitely a nice retaliation coming from Infused. They haven't tilted. They recognize that they still need to be proactive with their decision making. They still need to be making plays around the map and doing what they can to pick up any gold that they can get. And so very impressive play from Infused, keeping a very strong mentality and making sure they're doing what they need to do in order to stay in this game. So, Dragon Timer just popped up in the top left of the screen. 1 minute 45 until that respawns, and I imagine both teams now are going to hang around and wait for that, and that will be the next major objectives that both teams start to contest.
Absolutely, and something important just happened here, guys. Murmana has just transformed for Toaster's Urgot. This next fight, he's going to have it. He's going to be doing way, way more damage. This is kind of like the Triforce spike you get on a Corki. It is a good opportunity for FM to really make something happen.
That is definitely the case, and what better a time to get it just as the dragon is spawning. You can see now both teams looking to contest for vision. They are putting pink wards down, they're getting what vision they can around the dragon pit to set themselves up for this next objective. And we'll see now whether or not. One other thing we need to mention is Orianna completed that Athene's Unholy Grail as well as a needlessly large rod. So I wonder whether or not she's going to head towards that Death Cap or maybe a Ludens. I wouldn't be surprised to see a Death Cap coming out next, but we will have to see what he decides to do. Another important thing to note is the upgraded trinkets coming out for both Zivis and Tundra. It's something that's been happening more and more recently with regards to your mid laners and top laners, rather than because generally junglers will now get Sightstone as well as the support to add even more vision control to the map. By upgrading your trinket from the mid laner and the top laner, you can basically have full vision control over the map at all times. So it's definitely a nice decision coming out from the side of FM, and I'm a big fan of it.
Yeah, and talking about items, and Ziv is, I don't got time for that. Tundra in the top lane, massively cut out, gets his ultimate interrupted there, and he goes down. Not ideal for FM. They are going to get the dragon, but they might lose a tier 2 tower here. I'm not sure they can afford that kind of trade.
Well, it's very debatable because right now they are very behind in towers, and I'm not sure if Zivis is going to be in a position to defend this. Flashes up for Alfari.
Oh, they're going for it, kind of. You know, they just want to be able to walk back and forth behind the tower a little bit more quickly, so they seem more threatening. But here we go. Zivis moves up a little bit, uses that shockwave, but it doesn't have much of an effect. He goes down. Charlie T finds Toaster on the sidelines. Toaster having the kite back here. Tundra, he's back, though. Toaster is very low. Alfari trying to chase on him, but look at this escape from Toaster. He's kiting back constantly. Do they have the damage? Oh, he's in the middle of everyone. Gets taunted up by Tundra. Tundra doing a good job of sticking on him right now, and actually Memento's AP build really starting to shine here. Oak just getting away. Toaster, he healed up a lot over that fight, but definitely one that went in favor of Infused.
Oh, it's carrying.
Oh, he's staying in! What are you doing, Toaster? That was questionable at best, and a downright mistake at least.
So this all started with Zivis trying to defend that top lane tower. He felt like he could hold it, but he ends up getting caught completely out of position. He holds his cleanse for way too long and ends up losing his life as a result. And what we saw there was basically a 4v4 team fight because of how quickly they were able to pick up Charlie T. And it brings us back to the original point that you made, that FM have no damage. Toaster was hitting whoever he could, but he just couldn't get through the front line that was Infused. Meanwhile, on the back line, Polk was just doing so much damage on that Sivir. He's now 7-2 with an Infinity Edge and Phantom Dancer, and you just cannot compare the damage of Polk to Toaster because it's just uncomparable. He's just doing so much damage, and it's just literally, as you said at the start, they just don't have the damage to get through the front line of a Maokai and an Alistar.
I think Zivis, you know, we were talking about items earlier, he's got to get the Death Cap. I don't think there's an option. He needs to be providing high damage. I think he needs a Death Cap and full 40% CDR, so he's kind of like an AP version of an AD carry with just large, continuous amounts of damage output. If he doesn't have that, I don't really think the FM can, you know, exist in this late game. There's the ultimate, they're going in. Great flash over the wall. Zivis gets taken out immediately. Nutri doesn't have much of a way out of here. Uses that explosive cask. Quick two kills for Infused, and actually Toaster needs to be careful here not to bite off more than he can chew. He's doing decent damage, but swapping into that Alistar, not a good idea, buddy. There's the Chaos Storm. Tundra taking a lot of damage on the side. FM, this is lights out. They lost momentum, and as a result, I don't think they can win this.
Yeah, it's not looking very good right now for FM. With an 8,000 gold lead in the favor of Infused, they are looking to put a bit of a strange teleport coming out from Alfari. I guess he wanted to try and defend that top lane tower, but decided that this bottom inhibitor was a lot more important. And what we saw right there was the problem with Orianna. She's got no defensive abilities to keep her alive. We do see all flashed on.
Oh, that actually does land on three. That's a big one. Shockwave on the four. Lots of AoE going down here, but there he goes. Zivis gets taken out again. It just doesn't matter. The game has gone on too long, and no matter how good the crowd control is, the damage is not there. Our fan, he's kind of stuck, I think, and he is likely going to go down. Maybe not. Depends on Toaster. He does pick it up. Alfari is going to be coming up next. Toaster, he's doing as much as he can to defend here, but an inhibitor's down at 23 minutes. I mean, what do you do as FF?
Think about what you can do coming into the next game. At this point, it's not looking great. There's always the risk that Infused throw again. You can see this time, this is exactly what I was saying from Infused the last game. They ran a comp that required very specific win conditions. This game, they're a lot freer to make mistakes. If they get caught out, it's okay because their team fight is just so incredibly strong. Their composition is just so well-rounded that it covers so many bases, and this is what they needed to be doing last game, and this is what I expect them to be doing this game. You know, this is sort of classic Infused. They need that very well-rounded composition, and as you rightly said, they outpicked FM this game. I don't know what the rationale behind the Urgot pick was, but if they'd picked a slightly harder carry, AD carry, I mean, they saved their AD carry pick for the end. They saw the Civic, we could have gone with the Vayne again. And with an Orianna to offer a bit more peel for the Vayne, and with a Shen, Vayne might have worked very, very well against that composition. But for some reason, they decided to go for this Urgot, and it just hasn't worked out for them. So at the moment, it's not looking great. If they can maybe get a Baron Steel, or maybe get a few picks here and there, there's a way for them to get back into the game. Meanwhile, Wisdom called out.
Yeah, and this is a big engage coming in from Infused. Lots of speed ups popped, but with the tower there, it's hard for them to go. And Arfan actually taking a lot of poke from Ziviz. Does need to be a little bit careful, but here comes Memento. He was stealth. Now he's coming in. The flash pull failed, and Ziviz gets out of there. He doesn't have the mana, though. That's a lot of AoE coming in from Colt and the rest of Infused. Charlie T doing a lot of damage. That could have been really good if Ziviz had mana, but without it, Infused just take it so easily.
Well, Ziviz only altered Alistar. I mean, I'm not entirely sure what his plan was. He wasn't in a great position there, and his ult completely whiffed, and I'm just not a fan of Orianna. She's not a bad champion by any means. I just don't feel that teams are used to playing her. They just pick her because they don't know what else to pick into Victor. And this is a problem for teams that I feel. They need to think about things that can do well into Victor. And as a mid laner, I know there are plenty of things available. I do wonder why they banned Azir, to be honest with you, because while Azir has had some nerfs, it's still definitely a viable champion. And if Charlie T chose to pick Azir, that means that Ziviz could have picked Victor again. And again, that matchup is a very even one that can go in both ways. But I feel like FM, in coming into this next game, which is highly likely, need to think about this pick and ban very clearly. They will obviously have the first pick, so they might be looking to first pick the Victor instead. And we'll have to see, but right now, not the best performance from FM, and I think it is largely down to getting caught out a few too many times and just a slightly weaker team composition.
Yeah, and I think, you know, Victor has really been the lucky charm of a lot of teams in this tournament. We haven't seen it do poorly practically ever. I can't think of a game that it's lost, actually. So if they can first pick it, I would. If they don't want it, I would ban it, you know?
Arfan.
Ooh, he does actually get caught out here. Explosive cast keeps him close, but it doesn't do much, to be honest. Alfari actually looked like he wanted to go in there. Gets Face of the Mountain, I believe that, or a Quicksilver Sash on Alfari. Whoa. Okay. Oh. So he uses that to get out of there.
Okay. Well, I mean, I can understand it. There is quite a lot of... Yeah, there's a fair amount of crowd control coming out from the side of FM, so he just wants it to be able to get onto the back line a lot easier. You can see the flank coming out from Memento. I wonder whether or not he's going to try for any engage. He does have his ultimate available, but that draws Ziviz away long enough to be able to get the tower. Meanwhile, engage in the mid.
Yeah, they're trying to find something here. Polk is doing a lot of damage onto Toaster. Now he's got Alfari running in Nutri, trying to keep them off the back line, but Memento sweeping him up. Decent ultimate from Ziviz, but look at how little damage it does. Memento, he's the next target, but it doesn't even matter. Infused are rolling through the base of FM right now. This is going to go to a game 3. It's down to the wire, VDS.
It is indeed, and it does look like the definitely a much quicker game compared to their first one. Infused got an early lead and they held it this time, so we will have to see whether or not that changes coming into game three. We will be taking a short break as we set up the next match, but don't go anywhere. Stay tuned with us and we will be back with game three for this final of Infused versus FM. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. It turns out that we are actually going to go to a game three for this final between FM Esports and Team Infused. First game was a very close game between both teams. The second game saw a very dominant performance coming out from the side of Infused. So we will be going into game three in a little while. But tell me, what are your thoughts coming into this third and final game?
Man, it has been a lot of awesome league over this weekend, and I really think these two teams do represent the best two of the tournament. From what I've seen, the games between them have been very close, but both games of the finals, the pick and ban phases have been what have determined the outcomes. I would like to see both teams step up their game in that respect. Stop picking Urgot and start picking things that make a little bit more sense. Now, Victor being banned, hallelujah, that makes so much sense. They're listening.
So we will see different mid laners this game, other than Orianna and Victor. And what, Orianna wasn't a bad pick there. I don't think the matchup is negative at all for Orianna. I just feel that Orianna is not a well-practiced champion. I feel like all mid laners are aware of how Orianna works and how to play her, but I feel like a lot of mid laners haven't perfected her. Like, if you think about Power of Evil, he regularly practices and plays Orianna, and I feel that, like, in particular, the two mid laners that we have here, Orianna's not really their go-to champion. So I feel like steering away from those and putting them on something more comfort pick based. You know, we've seen Zivis in Lulu in the past. I mean, that could definitely work if they want to run maybe Vayne again in the bottom lane. And same for Charlie T. He does like control mages. So we will have to see what both mid laners decide to bring out. But I'm surprised they decided to ban the Evelynn and Sivir. Sivir's not a surprising ban. The Evelynn is a bit of a surprising ban. I felt like Memento didn't have a massive impact on that even the last game. He did apply a lot of pressure in the bottom lane. But other than that, his and, you know, his impact around the map wasn't insanely massive, but it does mean that I wonder if they're going to ban Elise. Do you think they're going to give Nutri Elise?
I don't think they should. Whether or not they will or not, that's the question, because they've also got Fizz to worry about here. And they are going to prioritize Tundra over Nutri. Now, whether or not that's going to be a good decision is yet to be seen. But I am a little bit worried, because Nutri is Elise. That is some scary stuff, man.
Yeah, this is one of the first. Actually, this might very well be the first Elise of the tournament. I'm not sure if we've seen any other teams play this champion, as it's mostly been banned away. So this will likely be an interesting game. And I do believe Nutri prefers to go Cinderhulk when it comes to Elise. So we definitely will see a tanky jungler coming out. Meanwhile, on the other side, we see an Ahri coming out and an Alistar. Now, I really like this because Ahri is a very safe mid laner. She works very well into a lot of matchups and doesn't have very many counters. So it's a good mid lane to pick, and you can pick it very early. Same for Alistar. Alistar's been picked so much this tournament, and we've talked to death how strong of a champion Alistar is.
Yeah, I don't think there's too much left to say there or re-say here. You know, he's just really darn good. And now, looking at FM, you know, what they've got to think about what their response needs to be, because we don't know what AD carry or jungle that Infused want to run. That's kind of an awkward position to be in. You know, not knowing the jungle, especially, the jungler sets the pace for the game. That's something you got to realize. You know, they really put the pressure down early, or they focus on counter ganking and defending people and being a tanky threat later. We have no idea what it's going to be from Infused yet. So I would wager that it's someone with a decent amount of pick, but we'll have to see. And that makes FM's choice a little bit harder. I like the Vlad pick, actually. I think that's something which is sort of generalistic. It can deal with getting ganked. It can deal with a lot of the top laners you might be going against. A lot of the mid laners can do okay against Ahri. You know, it's a safe pick here. And obviously, Wisdom, his Trundle has been strong all throughout the tournament.
Yeah, the fact that he's picked it this early tells me that he picks Trundle into Alistar. That seems to be his go-to pick. Whenever he sees an Alistar, he'll just pick Trundle into it. And it seems to be working out fairly well. He did okay in the matchup, and he definitely had a strong impact in the early game. We kept hyping up how well he played throughout the early stages of the game. And that Vlad pick I'm also a fan of. If he decides to put it in the mid lane in the early game, it definitely goes in the favor of Ari, but Vlad definitely outscales. If he can survive the early game, if he can survive to that level 9 mark, then he will start to outscale the Ari, and he will become a threat, a massive threat that will go out of control. I mean, when we do see the jungler picked up for Memento, he is going to be back on that Rek'Sai, something that has been banned away from him from the last two games, but they've decided to give it to him this game, and we saw how dominant he was in their game against TES earlier on in the day. Meanwhile, that Corki again for Polk. He had a very strong game one, finished 8-4, but unfortunately weren't able to close that game out. So we'll have to see what the rest is available. We do have AD carry left and top and potentially mid lane left. So we'll have to see what they decide to do.
Ezreal again would be interesting. I mean, we've seen this earlier on today. I can't recall if it was Toaster that was running it. I think it wasn't. It was
In the TES game.
Yeah, it was in the TES game. But in any case, it didn't perform particularly well. So it's an interesting pickup here. I mean, one thing that FM have going for them this game that they didn't last time around is a lot of damage. You know, Vlad with the damage amp, plus, you know, even if she goes Cinderhulk, Magic Pen will be built to increase, like, the Sunfire damage for Nutri. And a True Shot Barrage over a Hemoplague can do a lot of damage. But whether or not that's enough is questionable. You know, we've got a squishier lineup on Infused this time around, but they've yet to pick their top laner, and that could be a very big frontline threat if they want to do that.
I wonder whether or not they'll go for that Olaf again. During the laning phase, it worked out fairly well, but coming into the mid-game, it wasn't that exceptional. But that is definitely a possibility. But we will see a Maokai. Now, I wonder whether or not we will see a lane swap, because I do know and have been told that Maokai does struggle a little bit in lane against the Gnar, but I suppose it depends on how confident Alfari is in this particular matchup. But yeah, I definitely want to say that FM have a very good late game composition. The longer this game goes on, it's definitely going to be in the favor of FM, because Vlad is going to scale very well into the late game. When Ezreal gets full build, he can throw out a ton of damage, and Wisdom is just going to keep getting tankier and tankier and tankier. So definitely a strong late game. Meanwhile, on the other side, Infused have a good mid game. As we talked about earlier, that Trini Force spike is very strong on Corki, and once Ari gets what, like, her first and second major item, she's definitely going to have a big power spike too. So I will be looking for Infused to contest these early objectives, these early Drakes, these early outer towers. I expect Infused to have a strong early game, and hopefully if they can snowball that, they'll win. But if they can't deal, if they can't find a way to get that early advantage and really make use of it, then the late game from FM is definitely going to be a big problem for them.
All right. Well, yet again, we're just going to have to wait and see. We got a spectator delay for a few minutes. We're going to go to a break. But guys, this is it. This is the last game of the qualifiers tournament. Whoever wins this, they're getting their team BYOC tickets to Insomnia55. It's going to be awesome. I got my tickets. If you want information on how to get involved and maybe attend the event or watch what's going on, lots of social media links should be popping into your chat in a second. We'll be with you really shortly. Don't go anywhere. This game is going to be awesome.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back for the last game of this best of three between FM Esports and Team Infused. This time, FM Esports will be playing on the blue side against Team Infused on the red side. Both had very strong performances in both of their games. Now looking to claim this last game and win themselves free tickets to the tournament being held, the Razer Challenger Cup tournament at Insomnia55. That is at the end of the month. Again, if anyone is interested in getting any tickets or finding out any information, all the social media stuff is available to you in the chat, so make sure to check that out. So we are going to jump straight into game. You can already see very standard starts coming out for both teams. Nutri and Memento trading blows a little bit, but nothing major really happening. So what do you think about this game? You now see the team comps, you can see everybody lining up. How do you think this game is going to go?
If I'm honest, I think Infused have the better comp. You know, I think if they put pressure on appropriately early enough and they don't overcommit to things, they've got the potential to snowball here. I mean, it just boils down to whether or not they're going to push their luck too much, because they have been known to do that earlier in the tournament. And in a similar kind of sense, I do think that with exceptionally good play out of FM, they can kind of deal with the aggression. It really depends, because they have a lot of disengagey style stuff. You know, Arcane Shift is a great spell at getting away in the bot lane. You've got the Pillar of Filth to keep people off of you. You've got Hemo Plague. There's a lot of things that FM can do to kind of survive these fights, but if they survive a fight and then lose a tower, it still puts Infused in the advantage early on. That's what they've got to avoid.
Yeah, that is definitely the case. And what we saw earlier in the day was that the earlier Ezreal game that you talked about was against an Alistar, and he really struggled against the burst that came out from an Alistar Graves, and Alistar Corki really isn't that much better, so hopefully Toaster's positioning is slightly better than the Ezreal that we saw earlier on the day. But we can already see Toaster being forced back from this lane. The early level 2 achieved from Infused. Fortunately, they are playing fairly safe, and I don't expect much to happen in this bottom lane other than being zoned out.
Yeah, I can't see them being able to CS too much early on. That's a lot of damage coming out of Ism straight away. You know, the poke really is very strong from a Corki Alistar lane. They've got sustain as well, so even though Wisdom and Toaster return some damage, it's not really going to stick on them for that long, and pots are already being burned. Wisdom, for example, has just eaten through a health pot, which is not an ideal situation to be in only 3 minutes into lane.
But he does have plenty to, you know, munch his way through, so it shouldn't be that much of an issue, and he does obviously have the passive from his item, the relic shield, which will also give him and Toast a little bit of health back every time he last hits a minion, whenever that is up. So meanwhile, we do see Nutri moving very sneakily up in the top lane. I wonder whether or not he's going to be able to get Tundra this lead, because in all honesty, we really haven't seen Nutri come top very often during this series. We've seen him hang around middle or and around bottom off, but meanwhile, ooh, Alfari.
Oh, the cocoon whiffs, but Alfari still flashes. That's kind of surprising. I actually think that was probably worth it from Nutri, even though he missed the cocoon.
Yeah, I definitely would agree. I mean, the best case scenario in that situation was, well, to get a kill, but I mean, the second best scenario was to get a flash out, and I mean, he misses the cocoon, but still manages to get the flash, so I would argue definitely a good trade there for FM, which means that now Alfari might be in a bit of a dangerous position, but meanwhile, in this bottom lane, we can definitely see a big, ooh, engage from Arfan.
Oh, that was a really nice combo into the wall. With the headbutt, he actually did a small stun because he hit him into the wall and he didn't travel the full distance, so he chained together a really long CC there. Very nice job in the bot lane. Memento, he is behind. I don't think he's really got the potential to go for a gank behind the bot lane of FM at the moment, though. He is just going to back on out. Great tunnels, though, are good for him. Charlie T with a nice charm in the middle, but he still gets cocooned. Ooh. That resulted in about half of his health getting taken away instantly. You cannot get CC'd in that lane.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if he decides to back off. He's got no mana. There's no real way for him to wave clear. And you can already see the pressure coming out from Zivis. You know, I did say early on that Charlie T on that Ari should have an advantage over Vlad, but apparently that's not going the way that I predicted. But Zivis,
oh, he dodges out the knockup from Memento perfectly with the Sanguine Pool. Really, really nice job there. Could have gone badly, but this is what I'm talking about. You know, there's a lot of escapabilities on the side of FM. They're doing a good job of curbing the early aggression so far.
They definitely are. I mean, if anything, the scariest lane is top lane, and we can already see Memento heading that way, but Tundra doing a good job of baiting it.
Yeah, he's baiting it into Nutri. I don't know if they knew that Memento was coming up too, though. That is a lot of burst damage. Tundra, he is the first to go down, though. Can Memento survive this? It looks like it. And that is an early start, an early lead over to Infused. Prey Seeker, it hits. One more attack would be enough to kill Nutri, but they don't have it. Unless Memento can get that cooldown down, it doesn't look like he can. Very close down to the wire fight in the top lane, but Infused, as she wrote the team comp, starting off ahead.
Tundra's TPing in the top lane, though. He does have flash available.
Oh, he snipes it out. Alfari, though, fighting in the middle of this wave, could put a lot of damage back onto Tundra, and he does. Tundra is already very low after getting into lane. Without any mana, though, Alfari won't have the potential to go for a kill, so not a bad trade at all for Tundra. Got to admire him for coming back from a bad situation.
Yeah, but you also have to recognize Memento overstaying, and this is something that we mentioned. Infused may well be a little bit known for overstaying, being a little bit too greedy. I understand that Memento tried to help Alfari push the lane back out, but it ended up in costing a return kill. So, unfortunate for Memento, but very useful and great for Tundra, really, to be able to get a kill back in that lane. And now he has completed his Hex Drinker, which is definitely going to be a very valuable item against this Maokai in the top lane.
Yeah, obviously Maokai doing a lot of magic damage is going to be nice to have that resist against him, but also if you look across the board, you've got some magic damage coming out of Corki, you got magic damage out of Charlie T, of course. It is going to be a really useful game item all game long.
It is indeed so. Meanwhile, we do see Memento again hanging around the top side, and this is something that Memento is used to. We've talked about it a lot during today's cast, that Memento does like to hang around and help out Alfari in the top lane. We do see him hanging around, though. Alfari goes in.
Yeah, Tundra, he doesn't have a Meganar nearby, but Memento, that is a long-distance tunnel across the wall there. Without flash up, he is not going to be able to follow it up, however. He's got to back out of there, no flash for him, Nutri as well, dissuading him. Memento knows that Nutri's here. He might go for a kill, actually. Here we go. That's a lot of damage. Cocoon comes out. Nutri's turnaround is pretty high damage, too. This is a close fight between the two of them. Chilling smites used on either side, but Memento gonna have to back on out of there. No support from Alfari was able to get there in time.
Yeah, that's really impressive from Nutri to be able to get out of that situation. You could see both Arfan and Alfari collapsing in on Nutri, and if he decided to stay there and pick that fight, he definitely would have lost his life. So nice decision making from Nutri, and good decision to get out when he could. Meanwhile in the top lane.
Oh, Alfari is getting dunked on by Tundra at the moment, but with Meganar running out, he's got to be a little bit careful. Now Tundra, he's turning around onto a Memento, comes in from behind, a great bait. I rate 8 out of 8, Tundra goes down, mate.
He does indeed. Very difficult for me to follow up onto that level of mateness, but nevertheless, they do succeed in picking up another kill onto Tundra. I feel bad for this guy because all that happens is Infused puts so much pressure into this top lane, and it's been gank after gank after gank, and unfortunately, all you can see is on the rest of the lanes, CS advantage in the bottom lane. CS advantage in the favor of Civ is in the mid, but that's okay, because as long as Charlie T isn't dying, he's still going to be relevant as the game goes on. Meanwhile, Polk might be caught out of position.
Yeah, it does have to use that Valkyrie to get around the massive trophy that suddenly materialized in the middle of the lane, but I don't know. Oh, Toaster, you gotta be careful trading with Polk, man. He does a lot of burst damage.
But so does Toaster. I mean, he's decided, it does look like he's gonna go for the tier build and head towards that mana Mune. Will eventually build into Muramasu. So I guess he loves the tier kind of champions, rather spellcaster AD carries rather than the classic, you know, AD carry. But, we will have to see. It obviously means that Ezreal is going to take a little while to scale up. But that sort of fits in with their comp. They do have a very strong late game composition. If he went for the Trinity Force, he would have had a very similar power spike to that of Polk. But by going for the tier, he has decided to delay his power spike. And that will obviously come a lot later. I do wonder whether or not he's... It does look like he's going to rush that Mana Mune. Meanwhile, Wisdom going a bit aggressive onto Polk.
There's a lot of poke damage going down onto him, but Wisdom might have stepped a little too far out of bounds, has to burn that ultimate in order to get out of there. Subjugate is going to heal him up quite nicely, but now Memento, knowing the ultimate's down, knowing he wants to go in, is going to come into the tunnel. Nutri's here as well. We've seen this a lot this series. Lots of countergangs in the bot lane. True Shot Barrage comes across all three, and both teams decide to back on out of there. Too risky to keep on fighting. Lots of action in the bot lane.
Yeah, there was no mana on Arfan and no mana on Memento, obviously, but they decide not to chase onto that fight and rather disengage. Which means that no action, well, lots of action happening in the bottom lane, but no trades. Meemaw flash in the mid.
What a flash cocoon on Charlie T. He is down for the count. Nutri picking that one up. Top lane, Memento coming around the backside. Yet again, Tundra is really struggling with all the pressure being put up here. But this time, he's got teammates rotating up to help him. Can they get there? Meanwhile, on the bot lane, look at that poke on the Toaster. Tundra's going to be able to get out, but Toaster trying to chase onto Polk at the moment with his missing shots. Toaster, he's low! One more auto would be enough. Flash forward. Polk picks it up. Very nice kill there for Infused bot lane.
Yeah, Toaster making a bit of a miscalculation there. He did have his flash available, but decided not to use it and hands a kill over to Polk. Now, that's going to be really bad for the side of Infused because Polk now has his Trinity Force completed. So he's going to be hitting that power spike already at 12 minutes, and that's not going to be looking good for the side of Infused. Sorry, I think I've done my math a little bit wrong. Yeah, I unfortunately have. So he's very close to his Trinity Force, but not quite there just yet. But definitely on his next back, he will have that. So he should have it around the 50-minute mark, which is prime time for that first Drake. So Infused definitely in a good position, using their comp the way they need to and looking to force these objectives coming into the mid game.
Yeah, and that's exactly what I want to see from them. Right now, though, we got a lot of pressure coming up to the top lane. The ward in the river bush will spot it out if they decide to go around, but I think Infused is aware of it. They're trying to wait until the last second to go in. Memento gonna close that gap very quickly with the tunnel. Now they're going in. Combo coming across on the tunnel, but he flashes out of it. There's Memento. He wants to keep this party going. Flash is under, gets the knockup, but where's the damage? There simply is none. And Tundra gets on out of there. Meanwhile, with Arfan being up in the top lane, this is the go signal for the bottom lane of FM to try and take the first tower. Nutri is rotating up top as well, so we're not even going to see the return kill from Infused. To be honest, VDS, I think this early game isn't going as well as Infused would like it to.
No, they definitely started well, but they've been putting so much pressure onto Tundra that they've actually basically given a free lane to Toaster and Zivis. Obviously, Toaster did die, which put him a little bit behind, but it's not actually going to deter him that much. He's still going to head towards his Trinity Force, and he's already getting fantastic stacks on that tier. So the moment that Maru Man is completed as well as the Trinity Force, Toaster's going to hit a massive power spike. The moment Zivis either decides to go for the Luden's Echo or the Zhonya's, he's going to hit a massive power spike. And Infused need to do something. Meanwhile, Vistam going really aggressive.
Oh, he's diving it, but there's a teleport from Alfari. Arfan's here as well. This could go terribly wrong for FM, and it does. Toaster tries to get a turn kill. He gets it at least. That was a bit of a consolation prize. Nutri is now the next target for Memento, who is just going to get cocooned up and be unable to continue the chase. So a 2-for-1 trade in favor of Infused. Very nice job there with the rotations down to the bottom lane.
Yeah, but not only that, they're now going to be able to pick themselves up the top tower, which will give them a nice 2-0 tower advantage. And remember that this game is a game of objectives rather than kills, so even though they lose two members in the bot lane, they do trade one back, and they're going to get the gold from the top lane tower, so the trade will be fairly even in terms of gold, and it won't hurt them that badly. But obviously they will lose that first Drake, but FM don't even want to fight for these first Drakes anyway. We've already discussed very heavily how they have a late game comp. This comp scales very well, and they don't need to throw away that composition. They don't need to put themselves in a massive deficit by trying to contest for these early Drakes. So taking away a tower at this point in the game for those Drakes is absolutely fine for FM, and if anything, that's exactly what they want.
I'd argue it's actually better, too, because when you're playing a team comp that does better in the late game, trading can pretty much only be good for you. You know, you get to your late game quicker, and you're better in the late game. And towers, that's something that you would expect in FM to have trouble with, frankly.
What
are you doing, buddy?
Well, that Charlie... He didn't expect that damage to come out from Zivis. That's all I'm going to say, because I can't honestly say what he was trying to do. He tried to go back in to get a bit of poke. Meanwhile, Ziv is getting locked up.
Yeah, but he doesn't have tower aggro, so they're kind of just tickling him at the moment. Poke isn't going to be able to get in very easily. Here we go. They're finally here, but Ghost on Ziv is keeping him out of range. And with Nutri here and the teleport coming from Tunner, there might be a turnaround. Arfan is very low. Great filthy pillar coming down, keeping him locked up. Burns that flash. Oh! Gets hit by the long-range cocoon. He is going to struggle to get out of here.
Meganar!
About to hit Meganar. He's going to keep this fight going. Misses the Gnar ultimate, but it doesn't even matter. The later game team comp doing the work in the early game. FM really showing some chops here.
All right, so miscalculations by Charlie has now put... Oh, Alfari!
Oh, he's taking a lot of damage again. Alfari trying to tank this up, but can he do it? It doesn't look like it. Charlie T looking for a pick here, but with all of the damage that's coming out. Oh, what a cocoon! That was absolutely beautiful. Memento coming in behind, thinking he's going to have an Ahri to back him up. No siree. Ahri got picked up already. You just got to get on out of there. Burn that cooldown. FM, what a team fight.
Wow, Nutri with the Mad Life cocoon coming out. That is so crazy. I cannot believe that he managed to pull out. I'm going to say that was definitely planned, and he predicted that from the start. That wasn't luck. That was all Nutri. I'm going to give full credit for him to that one, because that was so impressive. He flashed, he threw the cocoon. He predicted Charlie to flash as well. He landed on it, picked themselves up another kill onto Charlie, and right now, Charlie is just giving away advantages over to FM, and now he's not going to be able to deal with anyone. Look, we can see an Abyssal Scepter coming out for Vlad. Who is going to be able to 1v1 him? If Charlie had stayed even with him, if Charlie had done well in his laning phase and tried to use that early game dominance, maybe got a bit of assistance from his jungler, they really could have shut Civis down, which is what I feel they should have done. But instead, they put so much pressure onto Tundra. And Tundra, you can see, yeah, he's a little bit behind. He has died twice, but has that really affected him? No, it hasn't. He's not their major damage source. He's just a massive frontline beast that's going to throw as much utility down as he can. And as long as his team is throwing out the damage from Zivis, from Toaster, that's all they need. And you can see that that is exactly what is happening. So really unfortunate. I feel that Infused just haven't played to their team comp properly and haven't realized, oh, very close deal, but they haven't realized what FM need to do to win and what they need to do to win. Meanwhile, Nutri...
Yeah, they're trying to realize it now, but look at the damage turnaround from Nutri. What a pillar, too, keeping him in here for the chase. Wisdom coming down. There's a teleport from Alfari. They want to fight this. Arfan has to pop that ultimate. Nutri very low, going down, not quite. Repel keeping him alive for now, but not long. Tundra is not gonna. Oh, he gets Meganar. There's the ultimate. Gets Arfan down, and a flash over the wall gets him the damage on the poke to keep the fight going. FM! They are winning this by a hairline. That was amazing mechanics from several of their players.
Just like in game one, it is the Ziviz show. He flanked around from behind. His ultimate only actually landed on one person, but that didn't matter because he was throwing out so much damage that the skills from his Tides of Blood and his Q were just destroying the team of Infused. They have barely any magic resist, and considering how strong Ziviz is this early on into the game, there's absolutely no way that they could deal with him. And the team from FM tanked long enough to allow him to come in, get the damage down that he needed to do, and he picks himself up a triple kill off the back of that fight. Ziviz is massive at this point, and look at Toaster as well. He's nearly completed his Trinity Force. Let's have a look quickly at how many stacks he's on. He's already at 575 stacks, so he's almost at his Muramana point. And right now, that late game team comp that we were talking about is going to hit their power spikes at about 23 minutes. And for the side of Infused, this is not looking good.
Ah, man, they gotta get some picks. That's their way back into this. They've got a comp that can do it. They got charms, they've got headbutt pulverize, they've got tunnels and knockups. But what they don't seem to have is very strong teamfight coordination. This has really been going wrong for them the whole game. People escaping on almost no health, engagements mistimed. I think FM have gotten into their head a little bit. Wisdom, look at that. He pillars Memento out of the tunnel. Trundle, man. I'm playing it after I watch this. I'm not even kidding.
This guy is a Trundle god. I mean, we talked about how it's definitely a bit of a trade in the top lane, but we talked about how he generally picks this into Alistar, and like I need to have a chat with him and try to understand why, because personally I don't fully understand how it counters the Alistar. Like I guess the ultimate works really well against when Alistar gets super tanky, and so you can get super tanky as well. Like at the moment, that's the only way I can see, but I just feel like for Wisdom, this is a comfort pick for him because his ability to use the Pillar of Filth is just so impressive. He can interrupt abilities, and you saw in that last team fight how he completely split up the team from Infused by putting it in that very small choke point. And Wisdom might now be caught out.
Yeah, this time he's getting cut out. The ultimate's keeping him alive for now, but how long can it flash over the wall? He gets on out of there. Well played by him. Tundra, in the meanwhile, top lane, just chugging through Alfari's health, but he gets locked up. Does he have what it takes? He doesn't. Overzealous plays there by Tundra in that top lane. But regarding what you were talking about earlier with the countering of Alistar, you got to remember that Alistar, when he goes in, generally uses all of his spells to do so. A pillar is going to keep him massively out of position afterwards. Yeah. I think that's probably the biggest thing about that matchup.
Yeah, definitely. And not only that, it also prevents follow-up, if you think about it. I mean, if Arfan decides to engage, he can just put that pillar of filth right behind him, and that's going to prevent any... a very solid follow-up engage, because it's a very strong slow coming out from the Pillar of Filth from Wisdom, so I can a little bit understand it a little bit more, and it's very impressive. And while we do see a bit of an outplay from Alfari, I guess Tundra thinking he can dive a turret, but you have to respect Alfari. He's not weak. He's 4-0-3. And that he's not somebody that we talked about very much, but he's definitely a tanky threat. He's got two items complete. He does have the Righteous Glory and the Frozen Heart. And with the ultimate on top of that, he's definitely something to be scared of if he can get onto the back line. I mean, I honestly believe that Maokai at a point can, around this mid game, can actually 1v1 an AD carry. And with the amount of armor that he has, I'm not convinced that in a 1v1 situation, Toaster would actually win. So... Alfari at the moment, I feel, is definitely their shining hope, their ray of hope, their glory, their potential way back into the game.
Well, I think if that's going to be the case, he's got to roam down a little bit more. And with the pressure that Tundra is applying to the top lane by pushing out the wave so much, there hasn't been much of an opportunity for that. Memento might be able to go up here and try and facilitate that kind of a movement, but at the moment, he's not finding a good opportunity to do so. Look at this. 23 minutes in, the late game comp of FM. They're pushing an inhibitor tower as 5.
Well, they definitely are. Arfan does pop the ultimate.
Oh, Memento, he gets a 3-man knockup, but the tower is down. Zivis, he's very low. He gets healed up. Charlie T in the back line trying to kill him, but he just won't go down. There's the rocket from Hope. He takes him. Alfari, he's very low. Double kill with the True Shot Barrage. FM, they get a triple kill. They get 4 kills in total. They get an inhibitor at 24 minutes in the game. They are playing out of their minds.
Are they going to look for the end? They definitely have the potential. There's still 15 seconds on Memento, and they do have a minion wave available. Oh, 4-man headbutt pulverize.
Oh, this could seriously be the game here, Vedius. I don't know. We've got about 3 seconds till Memento's up. Everyone else is about 10, but they are going to back out and play it safe. I think that is a reasonable decision, although my hype would appreciate it if they just went for the end. That said, I mean, wow. They are playing so well right now. This is very much a game deserving to be in the grand finals in the final match. Really solid. Toaster's going to get a blue buff here. They're just picking up all the advantages.
Yeah, the most important thing to note is that Toaster had his Muramana completed in that teamfight, and as a result, he was destroying the front line of Infused. That whole fight started off by Arfan popping his ultimate very early, and they had to get a bit of a sheepish engage because they felt like they needed to make the most out of that ultimate. But they do what they can, and they do get Zivis very low, but a fantastic heal from Toaster keeps him alive just long enough to get as much damage down as possible. But that credit has to go down to Tundra with his flash ultimate, and he manages to lock up 2 members, which enables a True Shot Barrage to pick themselves up, a nice easy double kill, giving a triple kill overall to Toaster. Meanwhile, we do see 5 of Infused sitting in that bush, trying to get themselves a pick. Zivis!
They do see him with that sense, and Ziv is, he is completely cut out here. I don't see any way out of this. We're gonna get a teleport from Tundra, but I don't know if that's the best plan. He's got Meganar, actually! If he can find a big ult, this could be huge. Memento, he gets stunned up. That's a lot of damage onto him. It's a one-for-one trade. Can they get Charlie T? Toaster is just wiping everyone out on the side of Infused. And with those two kills, maybe we will even see a Baron attempt here from FM.
Yeah, it does look like they're going to head towards a Baron. With the jungler down, the risk of a steal is significantly lower. They do have a bit of vision on the Baron, so they definitely know that it's going on. Arfan does look like he's going to contest it, but you saw from that fight, or Arfan, what's he going to try and do?
Alfari's teleporting into the pit, but look at Tundra's damage. He's coming here, he's swapping on the Poke. He's about to go Meganar, he's going to get some base health as a result. He gets it, the wallop picks up Poke. Alfari, he is trying to do what he can, but he's got to run away now as well. That is Alistair going down. Arfan gets picked up by a boulder. Alfari, that's a triple kill for Tundra. A push down the mid lane could be good. A Baron could be good. FM, they've got options for days, and they are playing so well right now.
They definitely are. I mean, it's just Infused doing their best to stop the Baron, but FM weren't really doing the Baron in the first place. Tundra did a fantastic job of zoning them all away, and he has a fair amount of damage at this point in the game, mostly because the fact that he's level 14, his passive is spreading through. Memento, though, hanging around
Memento.
The side.
He's looking for that one moment to shine. He gets the Baron steal. Memento keeping his team in the game for a little bit longer. Oh my gosh. This is too much.
We were talking about one way for Infused to get back into the game, and that is definitely one of them. Memento stealing away that Baron. And it's a shame because Toaster told Nutri he was going to use the True Shot Barrage. He's going to burst it down, but Nutri did not smite fast enough, and he just hesitated a bit on the trigger, and that enabled Memento to steal away that Baron. And now there's still like a 9,000 gold difference between the two teams, and it's still not looking great for Infused. At the moment, they've been losing every single team fight, and now with the last Whisper completed on Toaster and the Death Cap finished on Ziviz, it's still not looking great for Infused.
I mean, this Baron, basically what it does is it says, look, it's going to be harder for you to push our towers now, but we won't get anything from it. Right? That's what the Baron does for Infused right now. I'm not sure. I mean, FM might wait for it to run out, but Infused, they're not really getting stronger. You know, their comp doesn't scale as well as FM's does. So what are they waiting for? What are they looking for? They need to get picks like they tried to do in the mid lane earlier.
Yeah, well, they do have a Baron buff available to them. That means that they are going to be able to stall it out with the Baron-empowered minions. And what they can only hope for is as they're sieging, as FM are trying to siege, they do their best to land a charm, get themselves a pick. If they can land that charm and follow up with the nice engage from Alfari and Arthan, maybe they can get themselves a pick off, and they just need to continue to repeat this over and over and over again. And if they can do that for long enough, they might find a way back into the game. But I honestly think FM is playing too well at the moment to enable that to happen.
And they are doing a smart decision here, I think. Going for some inner towers instead of that inhibitor is really going to let them
safe.
Ziviz is getting caught out, though. It has bought a lot of time for his team. He is ghosting out of there. Can he escape? It doesn't look like it. Put some nice return damage down, but it's not going to be enough. Baron enhanced recalls are going to keep them from getting into base because of that Hema Plague. There's a True Shot Barrage Exhaust keeping Toast from doing maximum damage. Nutri, he's getting focused. Arfan knocks Fistum back into the team. Can Infused hold this? I'm not sure they can. It depends. There's a great charm onto Nutri. It looks like they will hold it for now. Tundra and Toaster have to run for their lives. Crazy fights. I would have probably just waited for that Baron buff to run out, though.
Well, okay, so what basically we talked about was for Infused to get back into the game. That's literally it. They catch someone out of position, which was Ziviz. And what FM didn't do is they tried to push, knowing that Ziviz had drawn three to the bottom half of the map, but they did not respect the Baron-empowered recalls. And while the Hema play did prevent both Polk and Charlie T from getting back immediately, it's still they were still able to get back fast enough to prevent them from taking the tower. And unfortunately for FM, this, they need to be a little bit careful, because even though they do have a kill lead, a goal lead, and a tower lead, that doesn't necessarily mean that Infused are completely out of the game. We just saw Infused pick themselves up 3 kills as a result of that exchange, and if that keeps happening, then Infused have a way back into this game. The Baron buff will be running out now, so it will be easier for FM to siege, but I wonder whether or not FM are just going to wait for this next Baron buff to come up and force Infused out of the base, because when they don't have the assistance of a tower, I definitely feel that FM will have the stronger team fight.
I feel like FM, they could go for the middle inhibitor right now. So long as Ziv is with them, putting down a Hemo Plague that is going to give their team the damage. There's no exhaust for about half of the cooldown. That's a big one too. Arfan needs that to really keep Toaster and Ziv from doing max potential damage. That said, FM, they're playing it slow, man. They want to be sure they win this. 5 BYOC tickets, that's a lot of money. They want to make sure they come out ahead in this best of three.
Yeah, that is definitely true. And the thing is, what they might wait to do is for Zivis to complete his Zhonyas. Because what you really want is Zivis to go in, get a full rotation of his combo down, pop the Zhonyas or his troll pool, wait a little while for his cooldowns to come up, get another rotation, then again do the Zhonyas of the troll pool, get another rotation down, and that is what ideally you want coming out from the Vladimir. So they might wait a little while for his Zhonyas to be completed. I wonder how much gold he's currently sitting on. He's 100 gold off that Zhonyas. He might sell the Doran shield, pick that up, and then they might look for the next fight.
That is exactly what has happened, Vedius. You've got a crystal ball or something, apparently, but Alfari, he is trying to maybe catch out Tundra here, and I don't know if he's going to do it. Tundra has the ability to just jump over that wall, hit the Gromp, and bounce on out
Tundra.
If he wants to, yep. Alfari actually kind of mispositioning himself as a result of this, following him so far. Dutri is nearby, Wisdom's nearby. They haven't shown yet. The ward reveals him, but the cocoon comes down. Alfari is being locked up here with that filthy pillar.
Look at mid.
But Tundra, yeah, he's just going to back out. There's a mid rotation coming in from FM. This could be a very easy inhibitor if they push it quickly enough.
Yeah, they do have the teleport available for Tundra. He can join that fight whenever he wants. Meanwhile,
oh, what a pillar.
Yeah, fantastic pillar. They're going to get that inhibitor for free.
There was no contest. I mean, that's one of the things that the pillar does, because even if, for example, Charlie T decided to use Spirit Rush to get onto them, he would have been putting himself between a pillar and an enemy team. You know, he wouldn't have been able to get much backup there. So really nice work by Wisdom, really nice work from FM as a whole. Ziv is getting charmed up here. Is this an opportunity for Arfan to go in? It doesn't look like it. It looks like an opportunity for Arfan to take a billion damage. Actually, Toaster, though, does take a lot there. Tundra duking it out in the bottom and has teleport, has Meganara available if he wants to go up there. But he could get it canceled by Alfari if he doesn't use it soon. And it looks like they're just going to back off. Baron is relatively quick to spawn. I think that's the best chance for FM here.
Yeah, they do have the middle inhibitor, so there's going to be consistent pressure being applied. Tundra has... Oh, Charlie T ultimate!
Oh, Charlie doesn't get that charm, and as a result, without having the ultimate, he is going to be a little bit less effective here. Memento trying to go on to Toaster, but a great flash keeps him out. There's the cleanse as well, Quicksilver Sash keeping him alive, and now the rest of the team for FM is getting nearby. They're going to be able to turn for a kill here. Toaster doesn't have much mana. Nutri going for the random wind zone. Tundra coming in, doesn't have Meganar for ages. So Zivis, he's got the Hemo Plague if he wants to use it. Toaster, he's going to go down to the backline, but not before doing a lot of damage to Charlie T. Polk. He goes down. Tundra and Zivis are really what's keeping FM in the fight right now, with one of their carries out of it. Memento and Alfari trying to get onto Nutri, but they just can't finish it off. Arfan, can he do it? He's trying to. Repel keeps him alive for the Pulverize. Nutri lives. Alfari gets knocked into that wall. Zivis, he's got the damage to finish this one up. FM do a great job of coming back in that fight when Toaster was caught out. And this could be a big opportunity for them, maybe to get a tower, maybe to try and pick off Memento here. He does get back to base in time. Bit of miscommunication there, I feel. I don't think Tundra should have gone back if the rest of his team wanted to pick up this inhibitor tower.
What a crazy extended fight. That all started with both Toaster and Wisdom overextending a little bit too much in the top lane, and they got caught out of position as a really nice flank from Memento and Alfari came out. But Toaster had such a beautiful QSS. It does keep him alive for a little bit longer, but we do recognize now how tanky Alfari is. He is so hard to kill, but at the same time, Wisdom was just as hard to kill. Not quite as tanky, as the top lane from Infused, but nevertheless, he definitely posed a massive threat, and he bought enough time for the rest of his team to collapse. And the moment Ziviz and Tundra were in that fight, their sustained damage was just far superior to that of Infused, and you saw that in the fight. They do manage to win 3-for-2. Meanwhile, Wisdom!
Yeah, his turn around here tries to get that pillar on the poke. He's actually going to go down immediately here. Tundra doesn't have Megadar. This fight isn't going that well for FM, but Ziviz uses the Blast Pool in order to keep himself alive. Now Tundra, he's nearly Megadar. Can he go in here? Big ultimate, but only lands on the Memento. Arfan is very low. He goes down. Nutri on the backline. Gets the cocoon on the poke. That spells the end of that fight. Toaster chasing onto Charlie T. Can he find it? There's no mana on Charlie. He's not going to be able to do much to get away here unless Toaster messes up his skill shots. Is he going to? It looks like he misses the Mystic Shot. How soon does he have an Arcane Chip? Not soon enough. But man, FM, they are turning fights that look like they should be bad for them into good fights. They are so far ahead right now.
Yeah, I think Wisdom needs to be a little bit careful. He's not Alistar. While his ultimate definitely gives him a nice stats boost, he is nowhere near as tanky as that Alistar is, and it is still very easy for Charlie T to rip through him like he's a piece of paper, and you saw that right there. But nevertheless, the massive amount of damage coming out from Ziviz and Toaster enabled them to pick up another fight. Meanwhile, Memento hanging around the side.
Oh, round two, he's looking for it. Can he find it, though? Tundra zoning him off a little bit this time, and actually everyone grouping onto him. Now Memento's in the Baron Pit. Is he going to be able to find anything? It doesn't look like it. FM pick up that kill. No steal attempt possible now for Infused this time. Baron going the way of the team who started it. And with Memento down and a Baron buff on their side, this next push could be very deadly for Infused.
Yeah, so that time they played the Baron fight properly. They got the Baron very low, drew Memento in very close to the Baron pit, and then they turned on him immediately. Both Toaster and Tundra doing what they can to zone him away. It does look like Infuse are going to head towards this dragon, and it does look like, unless Toaster can get a Miracle Steal.
Oh, close. Oh, he gets it with a Mystic Shot. Not even through Shot Wisdom. Doing the same thing again, going a bit too deep. Gonna go down very quickly. Ziviz, he needs to zone. There you go. He gets it off with that Q as well, but a charm follows him off right at the end. And this Baron buff isn't even gonna get to be utilized properly. FM, they've gotta stop overcommitting to things. They're so far ahead, but they just can't end it.
Yeah, I don't know why FM decided to overcommit for that dragon. They'd already got it. Oh, meanwhile, Tundra.
Oh, Tundra, he gets charmed up. Taking a lot of damage. This could be him going down. Narzim into the wall. Afari's very low. Toaster's doing some good damage. Tundra is gonna fall though to Poe. And now we've got Toaster trying to run away from Memento and the rest of the Infused lineup. He's doing a lot of damage, but can he do enough? Apparently, yes, they're backing out of there. He is doing some great poke. And now top lane's got Nutri split pushing at the same time, trying to take down Memento. Does he have what it takes? Baron minions helping him out. Repel keeps him onto the fight. He picks up the kill. He's gonna go for the tower too. Meanwhile, Toaster's stopping all the recalls. This could be an inhibitor if he wants a Toaster. Is he gonna go down to poke?
Oh, Toaster!
He's so close, they both go down. Nutri picking up the inhibitor in the mid lane. This game is absolutely killing me, Vidius.
Toaster, take a break, man. I'll try my best to break it down. Toaster, Nutri might be going down to Alfari. He's doing his best, running through the super minions to keep himself alive.
God,
for Charlie T.
No way.
Lands the charm, picks himself up a kill. Oh, are they gonna lose that top inhibitor though? Oh,
nah,
it's
got
mind.
Too much health.
Hopefully, Wallace Siglas takes a little break, catches his breath. I'm going to break down, or try my best to break down what happened there. We saw that all started, right, where they overextend for a dragon fight. Can you believe it? That was so long ago, and Tundra's still trying to stop them from backing. He's dancing around, and all four of Infused members then turn on to him immediately. Toaster does what he can to help support his top laner, but then Tundra ends up going down, and it's basically Toaster 1 versus 4. He recognizes that his jungler is pushing the top lane. He does what he can to help that split push going, and Toaster manages to keep all four with him. And he gets Memento so low that Nutri's actually able to 1v1 him, and they pick up that middle inhibitor. So very well played by Toaster. On top of that, Toaster actually gets the 1v1 outplay. So obviously they do trade 1 for 1, so it's not a complete outplay, but definitely well played by Toaster. Man, what an intense game. I mean, mistakes. I have to admit, mistakes from both sides. FM are not playing this perfectly. They definitely had the opportunity to end this game earlier, but Tundra...
Speaking of which, yeah, Tundra gets charmed up in the top lane. He is Mega Gnar. He's going to be able to gnar them off if he wants to, but he can't get away anyway. Meanwhile, in the bot lane, Toaster picking up a tower. Can they find another one? Our fan is very low, but he's got that ultimate going. Now Memento trying to look for the knockup on Toaster, doesn't find it. He takes a lot of damage. Toaster picks up that one, but here comes Charlie T doing a lot of damage. Zhonya's keeping Ziv is out of the primary focus for now. Alfari, he is going to be the next target. Goes down to a Mystic Shot, long range from Toaster. And now the tower. If this goes down, this will be very bad for Infused. An inhibitor will shortly follow. They're trying to go onto Charlie T, can't find the cocoon, but it's not even gonna matter. Super minions are pouring into the base of Infused at this point. I just don't know what they can do aside from win a fight right now and push all the way to the base of FM. Can FM find his top lane tower? Toaster, he is so low. Zivis, he is the focus of Poke, looking for it. He gets him, but the inhibitor's down. Toaster, he's ignited. Can he get away? Charlie T, repelled onto. He nearly goes down, but Nutri is gonna die. I'm done.
That fight ends with Polk picking up a kill onto Nutri. They do get... Oh, the TP is coming in from Tundra. He does have home guards. He's going to chase onto Charlie T. Is he going to be able to pick anything up? No. He recognizes the onward coming out from Memento. Memento chasing onto Tundra. Gets the knockup onto Tundra. But I don't think anything's going to come from this. Tundra going very aggressive onto Memento. But he does decide to back up. Meanwhile, Toaster picks himself up a red buff. And nothing really going to come out of that. So, very good job play-by-play casting. You've got to give credit to Sigilus over here. Massive amounts of action going off across all the map, all across the map, and he's been casting. This is his fifth game of the night, so very well done, Sigilus. So you take a little break, you catch your breath. Meanwhile, they
managed to pick up
all three inhibitors, so that's definitely very good for FM, but they need to regroup, they need to collect their thoughts, and they need to end this game sooner rather than later, because this is so chaotic, the death times are getting so big, that if they keep making mistakes like this, and Infused get the numbers advantage, even for a little while, they're definitely going to be able to break the base of FM. So they need to be careful, they need to regroup, and they need to think about what they're doing. So, oh, it's an intense game, crazy action all over the map, but definitely not well played by the team. they've been making so many mistakes, and both of them doing very well to capitalize on these mistakes, but they need to stop making them, because at the moment they're never gonna win this game.
I don't know, man. I think Super Minions can do it. Speaking of action, Tundra is maybe gonna get caught in the top lane, maybe not. There's the filthy pillar keeping Charlotte in range for a boulder. That was clearly the intent. True Shot Barrage coming across, doing the damage, not too much. Alfari does get hit by that cocoon. There's only one Nexus Tower. FM really do not need to do much to push and end this. But there's just so little damage. I mean, everyone is so tanky right now that it's hard to kill someone. Alfari, he is getting focused, so Arfan comes in, gets a good knockup. So does Memento on Nutri, but he's gonna fall. Not enough people on the team backing him up. It is with the great Zhonya stays still alive in the back line. He can get out of there. Arfan, he's gonna go down. Nexus Tower falls. FM, they are going to be your champions for the qualification tournament, guys. Very, very well played, kind of, by them. What a great series. My voice is dead. Andy, take the outro.
So there was a lot of action going on in that game. Very impressive. Well, it was definitely, while there were mistakes from both sides, it was definitely fun to watch. It was full of action. It was full of crazy team fights, and it'll be amazing, spectacle. I'm really looking forward now to Ice Series. Maybe if we get a few European teams coming in from abroad, we can see other teams contesting these top two from the UK. You can see why these teams are the top two, though. Definitely a very close best of three series, and I feel like that the only issue for Infused in this game was that they didn't properly execute their composition. They had very specific win conditions and they did not follow them, and while that was definitely well played by FM, just a bit of a misplay from Infused, but I definitely feel that with their current lineup they have a fantastic shot at becoming the best team in the UK. Still very well played by both teams and a very impressive performance. So that was our final game of the night, guys. We might have an interview in store for you. We are just going to check if one of the players are available to have a chat with us. So we will be cutting to a short break while we get that sorted out for you. But thank you very much for watching. Do stay tuned to find out about a little bit more information. But yeah, we should have an interview coming up with one of the FM members, assuming that they are available. But yeah, remember that you can get your own tickets for the Insomnia event coming up at the end of August. The links to that will be available to you on the chat. Make sure you follow the multiplay for more information, and also make sure that you follow and go check out the Razer on Facebook and Twitter, as they have been very supportive in the tournament coming up for Insomnia 55. So thank you again very much for watching. Please do stay. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for sticking around. We do very fortunately have an interview with the top laner of FM Esports, Tundra. Hello, Tundra. Welcome to the chat.
Hello. Nice to be here.
Oh, thank you. So we definitely had a very exciting best of three series. How did FM originally feel coming into this series?
We still kind of felt like we were favorites going into it. But we knew it was going to be definitely a lot harder than the Epic Clan Finals, because Infused have improved a lot and have been trying like really, really hard with their practice and stepped up the game a lot. As you can see today, the games are a lot closer than the Epic Finals. And I think it could have easily gone either way, to be honest.
Yeah, I definitely agree. They were some close games. And for the first one, it definitely didn't look great for you. How do you guys keep your composure when you fall behind in the early but then manage to come back in the late?
Well, game one is a good example of kind of like stylistic differences between the two teams, where you can see Infused like to run this kind of early game, mid game spiking, like four skirmishes around the map, really scrappy gameplay. Whereas we rather just play like standard lane swap, just scale and like work our way into the mid late game and then go for a team fight composition. So as you saw in that first game, they kind of snowballed well early on, got ahead of us, but then it kind of got to the point where their comp couldn't actually end the game against us and they got impatient. The bottom inhibit, if I remember correctly. We got a really good fight with like Gnar, Orianna, or Victor, whatever it was, wombo combo, and then from there we just turned the game because we got into the team fight phase where we were a much stronger composition and we were able to close the game out.
I can definitely understand your viewpoint on that, but coming into the second game, I'm a little bit interested because you talk about how you do prefer these scaling team comps, and that is something that myself and Asigalus talked about. So can you walk me through why you decided to go for the Urgot pick in the second game?
Sure. So it's a comp we really like to run at the moment, this kind of like four tanks and sort of like this consistent damage mid to go with it, or like a lot of shields. Like I think we had the Shen Orianna Urgot combination. So just like really, really tanky team, but with consistent teamfight damage. The issue kind of came from we got caught out too much. Like, I feel like that game was in the bag near enough. Like, we had a good leads, we got out of laning phase well, but we just started to fall behind with turrets. And that was a big key point for us in winning the game, because our team just is really, really bad at taking turrets. And considering we lost all three of our outer towers before even taking one of theirs, we just got super, super far behind and we weren't able to get this tower pressure back because of our comp just doesn't allow for it. And then it meant we had to overextend to try and get these towers. Then we just kept getting picked, and Infused played it out really well and just outplayed us that game completely.
I see. That's really interesting to hear, actually, because Asigalus and I were discussing that perhaps that you were lacking a bit of damage, but I can understand your idea behind the composition, and it does make sense having you explain how you fell behind so hard during that second game. But we definitely saw in that third and final game you had that very scaling-centric composition, and when you went into it, did you feel that that was your plan? You were just going to play the passive early game and rely on your mid-to-late game mechanics?
Mm-hmm. So in every two, the 1v1 top lane is naturally in favor of Gnar. It just like wins out of pressure and requires like jungle help from the Maokai side to stay in the game. So we knew that they would have to put so much jungle pressure on top to keep the Maokai in the game, otherwise he'd fall behind, that we could then put our jungle pressure somewhere else on the map, whether it be getting the Vladimir ahead and putting the Ahri behind, which is what ended up happening, or just keeping bot safe and letting Ezreal scale up. But as you saw with that kind of composition in our playstyle, it really showcased how we like to play in that mid tier 3 push, where we caught them out of position, ended up just getting the tier 3 mid, and then a huge wombo, near enough like just one-shotting their entire team, almost ending the game at like 23 minutes, I think it was. That's like exactly how we want to play, just playing the strategical map rotation, looking for this big team fight where we just feel like we can team fight a lot better than other teams, because we have really good synergy and coordination. And then after that, it kind of just got a little bit scrappy, and people, it's a tendency we have as a team where when one person gets really fed, they like to try and 1v4 or 1v5 just to show off. Toaster does it on Vayne, and then this game, Zivic did it on Vlad. So we kind of delayed our game for like 20 minutes and the Nash deal. So it just kind of took a lot longer than it should have. We probably could have ended at like 23, 25 minutes or so, but either way, it worked out in the end.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that. I felt, as we were commentating the game, we did feel as though there were quite a few mistakes on both sides of the game. But nevertheless, you did in fact manage to close it out. So you are going to be taking 5 BYOC tickets home for FM Esports. I assume this is the lineup that you do plan on taking to Insomnia 55. How are you feeling going towards that tournament?
Pretty confident going into it. Although, no team has ever won back-to-back iSeries in the last like 3 years, so hopefully we'll be able to break that curse. But I think we have a lot of LAN experience with the team now, and we're one of the few teams that are actually going to remain the same from a LAN to 2 UK LANs in a row, which is a pretty rare thing in the UK scene. We're hoping to stick together for as long as we can, and hoping to keep this roster together for the Challenger Series next season. So this is more of a long-term project for us, I guess you could say, rather than just focusing on the next LAN. This is more of a going for Challenger Series, I guess, in a few months down the line.
I see. Yeah, you definitely, I believe you were somewhere around 700 LP last time climbing through the Challenger Series. And for a little while, you were actually rank 1 on the Challenger 5's ladder. So that must have been a very nice feeling. But nevertheless, very impressive performance coming from you guys. And is there anything that you would like to say to any of your fans or any shout outs that you'd like to make?
Well, if we had fans, I'd shout them out, but I don't think we do. But to FM, thank you to our sponsors, Razer, Sapphire, and AMD. And thanks for them supporting us for so long. Looking forward to i55. Thanks for Multiplay for putting up this tournament. It's really nice to actually get some more UK tournaments on the go, as there's been quite a big break from Epic. And just really well played to Infuse and Choke, to be honest. It's really, really close up at the top of the UK scene now. And I'm really looking forward to hopefully everyone just growing a bit more. And maybe in the future, we can get to a more of a European level rather than a UK one.
That would be very nice indeed. Well, thank you very much for your time, Tundra, and congratulations again on your victory. That is the end of this tournament. We will be seen again in the future around the end of August for the Challenger Cup Series at Insomnia, where you will be able to meet the legend himself, and perhaps you'll be able to see his fantastic Aurelia play, which is something I always get excited about. Nevertheless, if you do want any more information, do check out all the links in the chat for Multiplay. And thank you again very much to Razer. Make sure you follow them on Twitter and Facebook. So that's it from us. I've been Vedius. I was joined by a Sigilus this evening, and I would like to thank again the Multiplay staff for running this tournament and hosting everything. I hope you all have a wonderful night, and thank you once again for watching.